So they're gonna do economic force development, and they're gonna do economic forecasting. It just cracks me up.
No, we raised the munis issue directly or indirectly? Is it worth it?
You know, what you'll see, for what it's worth, in January is a different format for facilities. You might like it, you might not, I don't know.
Were you expecting him to be late, or did he say?
I haven't heard.
Okay.
The chamber does, on the recommendation of the chief.
There he is.
Okay, we're live.
Hey, Johnny, we're moving.
Let's call him again.
Also, he'll get it. Hi there.
Hey.
I heard I missed the comments after the meeting.
Is the chief's retirement party at 9? Start time on Thursday?
Thursday morning.
9 a.m.?
I didn't hear the specifics. December 15th, 2015, meeting of the Reading Board of Selectmen to order. Go over the agenda for tonight's meeting. First is reports and comments, the Selectmen's liaison reports and comments, public comment, and the town manager's report. We will then do appointments to the Climate Advisory Committee and the Human Relations Advisory Committee following those reports. At approximately 7:15, we will discuss and vote on the Wakefield-Reading intermunicipal agreement for the renewing of the shared assessor. But at about 7:20, we'll be meeting with the Reading Garden Club to discuss watering for adopted island and town buildings. At about 7:30, discussing a concept for a disability commission. Is Matt coming in for that?
I'm not sure.
Okay. Sure. And then we will be confirming the appointment of our new police chief at 7:40. 7:50, approving non-alcoholic licenses and special permits for early opening and 24-hour operation. At 8 p.m., the Rec Committee and John Feudal will be joining us to discuss the Birch Meadow Master Plan. And we will also be getting into the issue of the status of lights on the field. And following that, we will begin first discussions on the FY17 budget. And then we have approval of minutes after that. No executive session tonight?
No.
With that, I will start on my right. Mr. Arena, do you have any reports?
No comment, other than enjoying this seasonably warm weather. It looks like Christmas at 60 degrees this year.
There you go. Okay, I guess you got the memo on the colors tonight, John.
Yeah, well, it's Christmas party.
Hey, there you go.
So, tis the season.
Tis.
My turn?
Your turn.
So, I've visited two committees that I'm liaison to. One of them is the recreation, and we're going to be hearing from them later, so I'm going to suspend any report on that until such time as they show up, because I know they've got a presentation. I also serve on the trust fund committee, and they had many things to talk about, but the thrust of what was happening is there are some issues that are developing, and you might think this is odd coming out of the trust fund committee, but around backup transportation for some of our citizens for medical appointments and so forth. Not just seniors, but seniors and those that have a variety of disabilities and need assistance. Mm-hmm. And we've been able to, you know, work with a variety of agencies to make that happen. And part of the problem is some of those agencies are rolling back some of their services. So, in other words, if you've got a, which is not uncommon, if you've got to go to the hospital for a test early in the morning, several of the services don't operate before 9 o'clock. I mean, they don't operate maybe after 3. And so there's some backups that they've been looking at, but those are things that might be a cab that really doesn't have somebody that can properly help them in and out or be a companion. So these are things that are all being looked at, and you know, part of the reason that it showed up at the trust committee is, as many of you know, the trust funds in Reading probably total $8 to $9 million, would you say, Bob, somewhere in that range? And I would tell you that if you looked at the list, you'd find that there are maybe 100 different trusts that come to that total. But the single largest is the hospital trust, which represents probably 50% of the available balance. And that was originally set aside to build, you know, back in the 20s or 30s, you know, when health insurance was rare, to build a local hospital. And it was money that was put aside and left because obviously the hospital didn't get built, and it has grown to a very substantial amount of money under the stewardship of the trust committee. And so what's happening now, because there won't be, you know, a local hospital built, is that that committee over time has petitioned the courts to look at the wills and use the money in the spirit of the way it was given, helping people with medical issues. Maybe that's transportation. Occasionally, you know, it's a special request for an individual, and they look at those each one after the other. And this is a long and winding story so that you guys are up to date on, you know, some of the things they're looking at. We were petitioned by the social worker, the town social worker, to change the requirements to qualify, because there is a qualification of income or assets in order to be able to take advantage of some of these programs, particularly the RIDE program. And so in order to be able to qualify, up till the last meeting, you had to count, if you were a senior living with your adult children and maybe an adult grandchild, everybody's income in the whole household had to be counted, which meant nobody qualified,
right?
You know, or those in those situations, people didn't qualify. So we were petitioned to reconsider that, which was done, you know, by the trust committee, so that only the person who's receiving the services would be, you know, their income and their assets would be judged, which I actually thought made a lot of sense. But so there's a lot of interesting things that happen inside that trust committee, and they don't meet often, 3 or 4 times a year as needed, more often if necessary when things come before them. But since you don't hear about them very often, I thought it'd be important to give you a little more thorough report. I've brought with me some information around this medical transportation.
Sure.
If anybody would like to have a copy of it, I'll be sure you get a copy of it.
Okay. So,
thank you very much.
Okay.
Can I just add on to that?
Yeah, sure.
Where it's a rare topic. Maybe 4 or 5 years ago, there was 6 people that served on a hospital development ad hoc committee to figure out, you know, at the time, $3.5 million, what do we do with it? It doesn't seem like we're going to build a hospital. So Nelson Burbank, among others, was on the committee and talked a lot about the philanthropy in the town and how it's disorganized, and how if it were better organized, there's people who would be very willing to step up and donate things for the exact things you're talking about. Never mind someone that gave money in the 20s. How about
yes.
Today? And in addition, you know, they went over the document pretty extensively and said anytime the town is willing to, you know, go to an attorney and possibly then a judge with another side prayer agreement to broaden the spirit of this will again, we think it'd be a good idea. So we've never done that. But if there's ever a wish on the board to do either of those, I think the community would be very interested in supporting the elderly, the needy, you know, particularly around medical issues. The purposes for which you can use the funds now are very narrow, and even with a CyPray agreement probably will not satisfy what the community would want. But the point is there could be other donations lurking around the corner that could help those other ones.
I think, I don't know, maybe it was even longer ago, that when the whole issue of the visiting nurse, we're going to have the visiting nurse, and I think a source of funding
nurse
was
advocate
was looked at that hospital fund, and at the time it was decided that it was just so it was so conservatively written that it would take, you know, a mountain to, and I think at the time it was only $20,000 we were looking for that nurse advocate, or it was part-time, and that was a source of funding. And it was decided, I don't remember the reason why, that we weren't going to go down that path. But, I mean, this is certainly, you know, that and maybe other things, and maybe all of the trust funds, which maybe have, you know, time has changed.
I would say, conservatively, there's 100 on the list. And I maybe more. And they range from 5,000 to 4.5 million.
Right.
I mean, and they're all over the place. And I think that there's, I think Nelson's comments are well placed, that you've got this substantial amount of money, but there's, and you know, you've got a group that have done a very nice job of shepherding and, you know, good stewards of the money, but they've been so handcuffed in some cases because the original intent really can't be executed against. And this is a really glaring example.
I'd be interested in supporting that effort, and perhaps members of the board might join me. There's two issues. One is the purpose of the funds. The second is the nature and degree of what fund can be drawn off. Is it principal? Is it accrued interest? Is it only the annual interest? And all those questions get rolled into the discussion, and eventually, if we're successful, you get some broader vehicle that allows you to support some of these occasional and maybe not so occasional request, but I'd be in favor of it, of at least taking a run at the hospital trust, if for no other reason than the will of the giver is being thwarted and doesn't appear to have any vehicle to address it in the near term. And this is about as close as we're going to get, and is directly adjacent to the stated need.
Yep.
The other 99, I expect, are all over the map.
I didn't drill down.
Of course not.
But,
of course not. But I'd be in favor of doing that.
Yeah, there could be some other nuggets in there.
I think there are, Barry.
Right.
You know, I think it bears. That's why I don't mean to take so much time on a liaison report.
No,
this is
a topic
we've heard
about
it so seldom. That
yeah.
Sure. Revenue source for things we want to do.
Well, it's goodwill to the community. It's not just revenue. It's doing right by the giver and
things that we can't afford to do otherwise.
Yeah. What would we need to do, Bob, to kick that off?
I need to think about it, whether to first approach town council with the document and ask for suggestions, or first think of what we want to accomplish and then send it to them. I'll review the document and try to remember. It's very narrow.
It is.
And as in any legal issue, it's in the eye of the beholder. You know, you do something, and it's up to the commissioners to decide, and they have historically taken a very conservative, narrow view. I've never really done so with a lot of town council advice, for what that's worth. There's certainly no reason we couldn't have them go over it and give an opinion as to, you know, here's a list of 10 things we might like to do, what's in bounds and what's out of bounds.
It certainly can't hurt to
no.
give it a second look.
Are there any family member, obviously not alive from the 20s, but kids,
I believe
grandkids,
that was searched for a while back, meaning like 20 years ago, and in the Midwest there was one or two third cousins, but no, not of any consequence. And that would be a question that town council would have to address. If you want to approach the courts and petition them, you have to look for heirs.
Very good. Thanks, John.
Yep.
Barry.
No reports.
Okay. Kevin?
Well, I attended a CPDC meeting last night. Pretty interesting topic. The first one had come before town meeting, a couple town meetings ago. This is up on Van Norden Road. I remember that Sarah and Jesse Wilson wanted to build a home on their grandmother's lot that's on there. It wasn't going to meet. I think they had one or two ways they could do it. It was presented at the town meeting,
right.
Either going with a subdivision,
correct.
Three and put in a street and all that,
right.
or you can kind of do just a kind of a shoot back and, you know, push it one. You know, way in the back. I forget, what's the, do you remember the term?
The technical term
the
is
technical
pork
term?
Chop lot.
Pork chop lot.
Yeah, right. Yep.
Wait, you're in real estate, right?
I know, I should
know
all
about
one.
Those.
Yeah.
The dog life.
Yeah.
Where's the dog when you need it?
Which was really more just a procedural thing to kind of get them rolling. They still have to go through a final, but they had a good set of plans on there that's mm-hmm. that satisfied Conservation Commission. They had gone before them first before going to CPDC, which was a good way to do it. The other one, which was more of interest, was 258, 262 Main Street. So this is the old bridal shop down on Main Street. And if you're looking at it, the house directly to the right of it, a development company came in and has bought both of those properties and is proposing a retail first floor with office use on second, third, and partial fourth floor proposal on that site. So I definitely wanted to come down and hear what some folks had to say down there. The room was full with, you know, butters, and there were a couple concerns brought up, and the developers seemed to be very willing to work, you know, with those concerns, you know, moving forward. And in relation to that, that meeting is still an open hearing to the next meeting. The board, the commission, excuse me, had asked them to go back and you know, with their suggestions to revise their plans and get back to them. But if you get a chance to see the proposed building, it's actually a nice proposal where they're going to bring it right up to the front on the street. They're going to do the entranceway from the back, all the parking for the most part on the sides and rear of the building. And it was a proposal that allowed them to do the best they could to not show that it was four floors from the street.
Just set back.
Well, the way they did it, the fourth floor was a partial, so it was like, you know, it was, you know, go in 5 feet on all sides or 6 feet, whatever it is on all sides, and just make it a smaller footprint up there. The only part that really sticks out is the part in the back, because they have to have the stair and elevator tower to match it to get up to that floor. So, but you really don't see it that way from the front. It was a nice building. The first floor was all glass, obviously going to be the retail, and then it was a mix of composite material and glass moving up for the other floors.
Just kind of like what the and we had on set. That
very,
exactly
very much
kind of
what
we were looking for.
What the MAPC had been, you know, kind of thrown out as possibilities for
any
up and
idea
down
for what they do? I mean, I know it's early. Any particular things for the retail that they were thinking of? Or?
They don't have anything as of right now. They don't have a tenant that they're building this to suit right now. At least that they didn't allude to. The fact that it sounded like they were just building it and in the hopes of getting folks in there. I'm sure as they develop along the way, they're marketing it, I would assume. But, you know, some of the concerns that were brought up was, you know, is it going to be a Dunkin' Donuts or something like that? And it's just, the layout doesn't allow really for something like that. A lot of folks are worried about traffic and, you know, continually traffic all day long and all afternoon. But it seems to be the majority of this will be office. In other words, go there, stay there, leave. And so it's not really a huge traffic concern if that's going to be the case. But it's a very interesting proposal. That was on their meeting last night. Yeah. And then earlier tonight, John Halsey, myself, members of the Volunteer Appointment Subcommittee, had a couple of members that will come up later on tonight. We'll discuss them then.
Very good. Thank you, Kevin. I don't have a report, but I just want to exhort all town meeting members whose terms are expiring. We do have an early election this year, March 1st. The papers are all available in the town clerk's office, and they are due by close of business January 12th.
That's not a Friday, is it?
It is not. Is okay. It? I think it's a Tuesday.
All right.
So please get your papers, get them back. We'd love to have another town meeting, but right now it's not looking too good. We won't have too many, I promise. Okay, with that, is there any public comment on any item not on the agenda? Ms. Demigris.
I have a question. About what
you can ask me anything
about.
You'd like.
Great. I just heard something, and I'm not sure I heard it right.
Okay.
So that building that you're talking about, you said it's with the parking is in the back, and
it's
closer to the front of the street. The building.
Yes,
itself.
The building itself. Yep.
Will there be a front entrance, however, so it's pedestrian friendly, or is it just entrance from the back?
No, they're leaving that up to the tenant. They are building it with entrances on all sides.
Okay.
What they're proposing is kind of a lobby, a four-story lobby on the back side of it, where you access the stairwells and you access the restrooms and things of that nature. However, on that first floor, they did have on the proposal a door on each side, so on the two sides in the front.
Okay.
Yeah.
We all think Nails, pizza, or Dunkin' Donuts would be great.
I think that'd be phenomenal.
Or Jim.
Okay. How about a flower shop?
That's it. Well,
is there any other comment? Okay, thanks. Bob, do you have some remarks?
Yeah, I have a couple minutes more than usual. First, I want to draw your attention to what's behind me. You have three meetings set, actually four, in January. So enjoy the next few weeks off, because then you'll be busy. On January 12th and 19th, you'll see is the set of town budget meetings, and those will be a little lengthy this year. We'll discuss that a little bit later. The police chief badge pinning is hopeful for January 12th, and I understand there could be a large crowd if that happens. And then moving on in the month, the 20th is a financial forum that you'll see in your packet the FinCom is already planning for. So they're 6 weeks out, and they're already planning for this. It's an important discussion. It'll be a discussion of not only FY17 budgets, which is normally the only focus, but of beyond, you know, the outlook financially generally.
Bob, are you going to take the approach you took last year and ask the department heads to report their raw requests? And then
Yes, I have that already and have balanced the budget as needed.
Okay.
And then lastly, on the 26th, you actually have your fourth meeting of the month, which probably is a record. And I did want to draw attention in public that there will be a discussion that night of the new proposed animal control bylaw. We'll put that up on the website. It's been around for a while. The only reason we didn't bring it to November town meeting was because we have a regional possibility with North Reading, but now it's to the point where I just want to get the bylaw done regardless of what happens. Okay. And you're closing the warrant the same night, so that's not something that's generally the best idea,
right.
But because of the election and because of the budget meetings, this was the best way to have a bylaw discussion.
Wow.
And the bylaw changes, I'm not that familiar with. I know Mark has worked with town council on it. To me, it looks extensive, but it's probably not that meaningful. It's just completely rewritten. If you'll remember, I think it was last April, we went to town meeting with the first corrections.
Yeah.
The AG said ours was the worst in the state, and after we made the corrections, it was no longer the worst. If we pass the one that's in front of us, they said it'll be one of the best. So, and I think it's important, if you don't know, that recently another community tried to pass a firearms bylaw and used language that the AG cautioned Ray not to use, so he did not, and it was disapproved by the AG because it used the word hunting. So hats off to Ray for seeking out wise counsel in advance.
Yeah, and just to chime in on that, because both John and I were a part of that, he was an invaluable resource during those meetings in just that regard. You know, if you get it, what's the right way to write it up?
Yep.
You know, and he was great in that. So.
And he has a sense of humor.
Yeah,
yes.
He certainly does.
And he finds things funny about law. tonight, Gene and Matt and I were down Housing and Economic Development Secretary Jay Ash, who's also a good friend of us, stopped by on something called a Gifts and Gab event. So he was gabbing when I left.
did he bring gifts?
He was purchasing gifts.
Oh, good.
Oh, I'm better.
So he was in Salem last night, and he told us about that. He's in Reading tonight. I think the main takeaway I have from this is the Baker administration has boots on the ground, and they're just like you and I. You know, it's people that are doing jobs very similar to us or have done in the past. They speak our language, they know what we're up against. And his reason for this tour, which is worth mentioning, especially with nice weather and the holiday, is shop local. The merchants I've talked to, which admittedly is a small sample, are having a good holiday season.
That's good.
And they think the weather is helping them. And you know, after remembering last winter, it was pretty tough. Let's see, you're going to have in front of you a somewhat last minute request for early hours for New Year's Eve.
I saw that.
We've already seen requests from two restaurants, so as we've done at least once in the past, I'm going to ask you to approve it for all alcohol licenses to be from midnight until 1 a.m. to serve.
Is that already in the motions, or will we have to grab something?
I'll have to check. Did we do a motion or not, Paul?
We did.
Okay.
To serve alcohol food for all restaurants.
Okay, excellent.
I think that seems to be a reasonable thing. And and lastly, just for your information, there's an update on the legal budget in tonight's packet. That's all I have.
Thanks. I think in the interest of the folks that are waiting here, we'll skip over the personal appointments and the shared assessor and go straight to the Garden Club meeting. Welcome.
Thank you.
Sure. Demetria, you want to introduce your crew, perhaps?
Yes. Yeah. So, I'm Demetria Sekaris, currently the president of the Red and Garden Club. This is Denise McCarthy. She will be the president of the Red and Garden Club.
very soon. Suzanne McCants, who is chairing our Adopt an Island Committee. She's also a second president, I think, on the Massachusetts Federation of Garden Clubs. So she's a big deal. And then, of course, Penny Anthony, who is the chair, co-chair of the Civic Beautification Committee of the Garden Club and also a past select person. So we're here to start a conversation about water. We have a particular ask, but I suspect, as we all do, that it'll be the beginning of a conversation. You won't give us everything you want right now. The Garden Club has a mission that involves town beautification. That's one of its sort of things under this umbrella mission we have. To that end, our two committees, Adopt an Island and Civic Beautification, do two separate things, but they work together in that they beautify the town. In particular, to Civic Beautification, this building has been two-thirds renovated outside by the Reading Garden Club with the extraordinary efforts also of the DPW, where the gardens have been renovated. So the gardens that are still sort of looming up over the windows and looking sort of bedraggled, we haven't dealt with yet. But we would love to finish the job that we have done, which is outside the main entrance, around the back, and around the side. In order to do that, however, we don't need money for that. And we don't need anything from you for that. We can make that happen. But I have been asking a group of, we're very young for the Garden Club.
Not me.
Oh, come on.
We've been asking older ladies to haul hoses at the town hall. And we can't, we've sort of hit a point where it just doesn't make sense to do this anymore. It's irrational. So we need some help with watering the town hall gardens. There are two things going on at your town hall. There are beautiful plants that need to be supported with water because in times of drought, which is now every summer, for about 8 weeks, they need to be watered. You also have a lawn that, while I am not a lawn huge person, as I know you are, this lawn is sort of embarrassing, even to me. It turns into a dust bowl in the summer. It's dirty, you're coughing, and it's not right for this building. So we are asking you to look into doing an irrigation system that is a modern one, that is in the ground, it's hidden, you don't see it, it's reliable, it will last a very long time, it will be very water conservation oriented because it will not go off in the rain, for instance, because it will be modern. That's the number one ask, and I'd like to have that conversation with you. The second thing that I would say is, since I think we suspect that might not happen immediately, we'd like to talk about an interim approach, perhaps for next year, where maybe we'll do something laying soaker hoses or something. But that's not an ideal thing. You don't want to look at soaker hoses, et cetera. So that's number one. The second part is the Adopt an Island element. We have three kind of kinds of islands. One of the things we're doing this year is reducing the number of islands in our scope because, as you know,
we
have over 100. And if you've judged those, you've driven all over the town, and it's too unwieldy, and we can't keep our arms around it anymore, so it's no longer as effective as we want it to be. But that we'll take care of. The three kinds of islands that we're concerned about are the gateway islands. When you drive up from Stoneham, there's an island on your right. Welcome to Reading. And it's not working. And it's recently, I believe, been adopted by the Chamber of Commerce, which is great news, but it's gonna need irrigation. And that's up to the town. Also, the gateway coming in, like from REI or Cumberland Farms, Mandarin, out in that direction, that island is, and it needs an irrigation system also, because it's an important entrance to the town. There are retail islands which are also critical. There's the one by Sims Jewelers and the Pizza Place. There's the one by the Walgreens or what used to be the Walgreens. And then there's the one that strip in front of the Bank of America, Christopher's area.
And this one.
Oh, and this island.
That's
that should be covered.
Isn't it?
Yes, and it should be covered by irrigation here.
Right.
You're right. And this island. These would benefit greatly from an in-ground irrigation system. This is not an unheard of thing to do. Wakefield does this, Winchester does this. Stoneham might. So it's not unheard of, it's just a matter of doing it. And then you don't water all the time willy-nilly, but what it allows is for these islands to be successful. Because right now what we have to ask people to do is take a really large island, fill it up with expensive plants and mulch and make it look good, and then carry water to it. And if you've ever hauled water, it's not easy, and it's too much to ask. That's what we're learning. So if you want them to be successful, as we do, it makes sense to support them with an irrigation system of some sort. The final kind of island that's kind of critical, if you haven't noticed, down by the train station, there are now 6 really beautiful faux ceramic pots. They're not real ceramic, obviously. They're large, and we've planted them with cherry trees. The town bought the pots for a very good price. And we bought cherry trees, which we've planted and will find adopters for. Those are instead of the little tiny...
The barrels?
Barrels. So we've got now half barrels and half pots.
Okay.
So in the spring, we're really hoping that the town will supply 6 more pots, and we will then supply 6 more cherry trees. We'll have an alley of trees.
Hmm.
It's starting to create the right scale down there, because right now it's idiots. It's just not right. But they need to be watered. And I am not comfortable asking people, most of whom, again, are older ladies who want to help out. Some are younger people, but come on, to haul that much water. So I want a water truck, and I know there is one. I know this can be done. I know it can be done. It's just a matter of will. So that's our ask. Am I missing anything?
No, I think that what we had discussed amongst the four of us in the big picture of Welcome to Reading and supporting merchants in the town and wanting people to shop local and wanting businesses to come in and wanting the right kind of people to move into town, a garden ain't gonna do it. But if you beautify the town, and if we are one of those towns where people drive through Main Street
right.
and say, wow, it's really kind of nice looking here, that helps us present ourselves visually, not to the soul of the town, but it helps present us visually so that people will have a second look, so that merchants will want to come to town, so that people will want to come and shop local and
right.
stroll our streets. So it behooves us to take care of that, and unfortunately what will take care of that is we've got the people to do it, but we don't have the water to do it.
Right.
So that's part of the backstory of our ask.
Yeah, Bob.
I have another request. I'll partner with them.
Awesome.
As of last April's town meeting vote, we no longer have watering for the downtown flowers. So
right.
we're able to muddle through the rest of this growing season, but as of next spring, that is not funded.
Did we do it last year at the town, or did we do it out of the
We took care of it through the end of the year
mm-hmm.
from prior funds plus some of our own funds. But, you know, there's no funding source for that, for watering flowers, if we go ahead and keep having the flowers hung downtown. So it's a similar issue. We'll just throw it out there right now.
Yeah, Camille.
Yeah, Dan, if I could just speak to that. I had spoken to people on economic, the old Economic Development Committee. All these tiny little baskets of flowers, I think, are silly. And they really don't make a statement. They're nice.
Mm-hmm.
But if we're going to do flowers, it seems, I mean, you see some communities, they've got these really gorgeous. And it seems as though we could do it in a much more streamlined,
yeah.
we don't need them all over,
yeah.
but you have them in certain.
That would help.
Winchester does a really nice job.
Winchester
right.
hits it out of the park every year.
Where's the funding from Winchester?
Chamber of Commerce, 100%. But you need Kathy Alexander over here to twist everybody's arm. That's what you need. Or Camille.
Oh. Yes, Jean.
Hi, Jean Delios. Yeah, so
I've been involved in this for the many decades that I've been doing community development and local government. And one of the models is used when I work with the city of Peabody is to have a partner like the chamber and develop what we've been talking about for quite a while is this partnership model. So it's the garden club and the town and the chamber and the business community getting their arms around whatever we want to do and combining resources. And in Peabody with the hanging plants, for example, it was a partnership between the town and the chamber, and the chamber would actually sell sponsorship on each of the plants. And it was a very tastefully executed sponsorship. You'd have your name on one of the hanging plants. And I have some photos that I'd be happy to share of how they did it in Peabody. And that's just one model. So I guess my point is that whole sharing and combining resources, I really think is the name of the game. And then it's just a matter of deciding what we want to do together.
Camille, then Dimitri.
Okay. I'm just curious. I understand we have a water truck. That's correct, right, Bob?
Not that I know of. Shane, do we have a water truck?
We have a trailer with a sprayer on it.
Okay.
Yeah, but that's what I want to know is, are we watering the new trees that are being planted?
Yes. I happen to.
Are we watering them?
We being the
summer avenue, like those?
Oh, all over.
All over town.
All over.
New,
like
down
those
down.
Are the canvas.
Yeah.
New trees.
New trees.
You are watering those once a week or whatever. Okay.
These are the ones with the canvas sleeves that we see.
Yeah, if you see the bag, they're definitely filled them. I just was talking to who's the young guy.
Mike? Is it Mike?
Yeah, the tree guy.
He's great. Great. I can't say enough about him.
So may I?
Yeah, you may.
I'd actually like to add another layer to this, which is because I realize that we're taking time here and the police chief is coming up, but the police building is also a building that the landscaping around it, if you're a police officer who really takes pride in like neatness and what it looks like and being right, it isn't working over there because they don't have the right situation. So that also needs, the public buildings need to be paid attention to because it matters, like that outside. Don't get me started about the schools, that's another thing. But that is another thing, right? I mean, you have to understand that the value of these public buildings is tremendous and you want the value to grow, not to diminish, so the landscape helps to grow it, if it's working.
Okay. Yeah, John.
A lot of great ideas. Have you priced any of them?
No.
I think we got the irrigation for town hall priced. I don't remember off the top of my head. It wasn't cheap.
Yeah.
Nothing I heard was
we
cheap.
Also
that
I
doesn't matter.
I am more
I mean.
Than happy to get you prices, but I don't have any idea how a town needs to. I know how I would price something.
Mm.
I'd call three guys I trust and have them come over, walk it, talk it, and give me a price.
Mm.
But I don't know if the town needs to do something different.
We do the same depending on what they say. That may be sufficient, it may not be sufficient.
Yeah.
We also discussed, Dimitri and I, the new library, and that was never envisioned to have irrigation in that, and that would be another location.
Which
where
is wildly.
A new building, you could, but
a huge
expensive.
Opportunity.
Let's get the friends cranking
building.
On that one.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And just another thing, because a lot of people who have homes that are well established and gardens that are well established and no one's watering them, I want you to understand, it doesn't mean that we're going to be, that irrigation system needs to be turned on every day for, no. We're still going to make those plants work hard for their water because it helps them. It's just that we don't want them to die. And we don't we want to finish this job at the town hall. We can't if it isn't. If we don't see an end, I mean, I cannot ask people to haul hoses for years and years and years, so.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah.
Just to clarify that, I understand the grass, the lawn part. When you talk about the beds or the pots or what were the other things you talked about?
And the islands.
The islands. Are you wanting to irrigate those or with a timer and all the conveniences?
So,
or are you talking about putting a water delivery there which somebody would then administer as weather and circumstances allowed, so you don't have to carry it in.
Currently, we have hose spigots here, That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about a dedicated irrigation system plumbed right into the building on a separate timer, different zones, so the grass gets what it needs and all the plants get a drip around it, and then you don't see it, you don't have to think about it.
But the same at the islands, the same at the pods.
Then the gateway islands and the large retail islands, and arguably at the police station as well, they should have a dedicated irrigation system as well. It would probably be a spray, because you know, it's an island, you don't have to do all this nonsense, but a spray would be needed. So that's what they have in these island programs in nearby towns. And then in the containers, the water truck.
So I understand the irrigation system all too well. and you know, every time the water bill comes, my wife chases me with an axe.
Right.
But so I do understand that.
I pay admission to see
them. Sell tickets to that?
I mean, it's pretty entertaining. I don't run very fast. I really dull the axe down. However, like the island and, you know, coming in from Stone, do you have to sink a well? I mean, how do you get to the water source?
I don't know. That's a detail.
I see. Detail.
Someone back to you.
Assume a water source.
Water
source.
Yeah, exactly.
There is water. It's somewhere under the ground in pipes, and someone's.
It is somewhere.
It's in aquifers.
Honestly, I have no idea.
All right.
Okay. If it can't be done, it can't be done.
It's running at a
but
very
I'm
high
sure
pressure
it can be
down
done.
There.
Well, anything could be done.
A man on the moon. So
you
we
know.
Can water that island.
I mean, but there's an 18-inch main down there.
Yeah.
You know, no.
They
no.
Filled by geysers.
Yes,
if I could ask, what would be the next step? We got to close the sale, you know. So what's the next step?
Well, Bob,
you're getting buying signals, you think, Camille?
Send me an email and clarify the locations. Town Hall, I understand.
Okay.
Send me the rest, and we'll get stuff priced.
Okay.
And we'll
and just to add this, for the first time this go around, you'll see a facilities budget.
Mm-hmm.
And just to be clear, all the buildings, town and schools, pay water and sewer.
Yes.
So it's not free water and sewer, just so you know, there's
right.
an operating cost. I have no idea what it would be for irrigation, but just to throw that out there.
As I explained, my wife is very aware
yep.
of that. That's not,
I don't know if any of these
isn't free.
Remote sites have they probably don't have spigots. If they had a spigot, there's inexpensive timers you can buy if you can work with a surface hose.
I imagine that stuff's not that expensive. It's $25
timers.
Yeah.
I've used them.
Right. We could do that,
but in a selective basis. Yeah.
Right. And someone will have to be checking on that. Someone who's caretaking the inside then has to start caretaking that, because it'll get broken. Someone will undo it. It'll get turned off, whatever. And, you know, and then the hoses themselves, those soaker hoses are not designed to last more than 2 or 3 years. So, and you have to look at them. So it's not an ideal solution.
But it's an order of magnitude less expensive, on the other hand. Yeah.
In the long run, you know, there are different ways to look at that.
Right.
I could argue for a long time that it's actually more expensive to do it that way, but I won't.
Yes.
I'm sorry, Barry.
Well, maybe
you go first.
Maybe when we get a price, we can look at maybe doing it as sort of a capital.
Oh yeah, that part's not.
Well, I think it is a capital. I think it's a capital investment.
Mm-hmm.
And then putting it in the capital plan. The other thing that is sort of what's mentioned is that if there's no water source for the downtown plants, it doesn't make sense to buy them, because they're just gonna they're just gonna die after.
Except unless they're clustered, as Camille said.
But you know, there's no there's no sense to go forward with that if there's no water.
Well, but understand that specifically about the island, that specifically about the new containers that we bought, we will adopt those, and we'll still expect everyone who adopts them to be watering them. But the water truck that we would want there, and I'll specify this in the email, would be for probably 8 weeks in the summer when it's drug time, as supplementary. We would never rely on the water truck alone.
Yeah.
We couldn't.
Are you talking about the ones in front of the businesses, the hangers? Is that what you're talking about, Barry?
I think he was talking about.
Yeah, the ones that downtown along along Main Street and.
Oh, without water, you can't do it. You would be throwing the money away. Oh, no, I'm sorry.
Plus, they don't, they're good for one season.
Right.
I think the things you're talking about are, they're there. I mean, they kind of.
Yeah, I mean, annuals are really fun and they can make a retail area really beautiful. And if you know Wakefield, they are amazing what they do in that downtown stretch with annuals. But you can't do it without water. But you're right, the backbone of all of those gardens are perennials and trees and shrubs.
You know, Stonewall along 28, when you leave Reading, it's one long.
It's beautiful.
Well, no, it's really not because
the grasses.
It's all along 28. I don't think they have irrigation, and so you have it, at least in the hot months of the summer, it was really, didn't look good.
That's the Father Gila and the grasses. Yeah, a plant that needs a lot of water and a plant that doesn't need a lot, not a good plant. But the one going into that mall, gorgeous, all annuals.
Just one thing from civic beautification. We would like to finish the front this spring. In fact, Lori Johnson, who has done the design on the rest, who's a member of the garden club and has her own landscaping business, she's going to be doing a design this winter when she's not busy. So, Bob, we just need to make sure that you people are on board that it gets done. You do have, what is that woolly?
Woolly indulgent.
Yeah, you got your trees out there are sick. Our trees out there are sick. So.
Yeah.
We just need to have a large bush in front of the town manager's window so I can't be seen. That's important.
I believe.
You like to hide.
Another thing I'd like to make sure we just leverage public-private cooperation in this matter as much as we can. I don't know, John, you've got contacts at Rotary. Chamber, is there a way to approach them on this? Have they been?
Well, I think that I think the chamber would love to do it. I think it's a question of funding. You know, I mean, they've got limited funding sources. One of their goals in working closely with the Fall Street Fair was that potentially that would be a way to raise money and gift it back. I mean, so that was, one of the things. But that's currently a public committee, and so that's going to find its way down the road. It's not a question of willingness, I think, by many citizen groups. It's just a question of figuring out how to pay for it. And sometimes, as Barry points out, a capital investment can be contributed to. Maybe they can help to fund the truck. And, a capital investment puts the irrigation system. I mean, you can't put an irrigation system in a pot. I mean, you gotta water it, right? I mean,
right.
Unless we're gonna, I mean, I'm still wrestling with the one down at the end of town there. I mean, I think you almost got to sink a well to get an irrigation system. I don't know how else you'd do it.
I don't know.
So the answer is that I think there are a lot of partnering groups that would be interested. It's just a question of figuring out in a partnership arrangement who could pay for what.
Can I deputize you to work with Bob on this?
Certainly.
Okay. Excellent. Thank you. John, do you have another comment?
No, John touched on it, and that is there may be other sponsorships or other parties that would be interested, and I'm not sure if the Garden Club has looked at. Obviously, you're putting the sweat equity into getting these things running, but to the extent funding is needed, other sources might potentially be sponsors of one or more of these.
I think over time, enlisting you ladies along with some other groups, which I'm happy to facilitate, we might be finding some strategic partners to, solve the ongoing expense as compared with the capital expense, which I think you got to separate those.
Yeah, the ongoing is the one that you got to solve.
And that's going to be the harder one for the town to solve.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah, one-time issues are one-time issues. It's the ongoing stuff that's the difficult problem.
And that's what we deal in all the time, because we're putting things in the ground and we want them to live for 50, 60, 70, 80 or longer years, right? So we're all about a sustainable solution instead of this will work for this year, this will work for this year. We don't want, so ideally that's what we'll work for.
Okay.
Yes, Bob.
So as part of this discussion, I'd like to have the Garden Club help out with the idea of what should we do if we don't do those hangers downtown.
You got
3 months
tomorrow.
To think about it in the winter.
Yeah, on that tomorrow.
There's got to be a better solution.
Something more targeted.
Yeah.
Something more sustainable, to your point.
Exactly.
Bob, when should we plan to get together to maybe assess progress on this?
I don't know. February is probably a good time on your agendas, as far as that goes.
All right, we'll set something up with you guys.
We could try. What are you doing on the first?
Well, this is great. Thank you all.
Okay, thanks for coming in.
So much.
Thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
Okay, we're going to, Chief, we've got one brief item ahead of you. Disability Commission, Matt, are you here to talk about that?
Yeah, Matt's here, and I'll hear, and Kevin's looked at it, and I know we have someone in the audience that wishes to speak.
I can answer any questions about it. I wrote a memo and researched the law. It's basically a local option, so if you want it, you'd have to put it on the town meeting agenda for, I think, the annual meeting.
Okay.
Appropriate.
Any questions, comments from the board? I think we should go ahead with it.
Comment on it.
Well, we have the...
Yes.
Christine Hanson, a resident here in Reading. I would encourage you to go forward with this and for our community to consider this, particularly in light of the fact that we're looking at a number of economic development plans that include businesses, housing, etc. And one of the issues that would be important, for example, with the Permanent Building Commission would be accessibility. Like many of you, within our own families, we all have individuals that have any number of challenges and disabilities, whether they're accessible, mobility challenges, and such other things. And I think it's important also, I know during a recent meeting with seniors in town, Bob mentioned that within our own community, our senior population is to grow exponentially, something about 75%, if I remember correctly, within the next few years. So I think in preparing for both our economic development and in the changes in our demographic here in the town of Reading, I think it would be important for us to consider a disability commission, a commission on disability, and invite those who have those type of challenges and those who work within the building communities and other entities to come forward and to share with our community so that we can make certain that we're not only accessible, but we offer assistance to those who have challenges. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, the idea here would be this group would make recommendations for local action.
That's the idea of having the commission. Okay. Right now we have an ADA coordinator who's Laura, but we don't have a full commission, and the commission would make recommendations as they saw fit.
Right.
So this wouldn't be a Board of Selectmen advisory. This would be a standalone.
It looks like it would be the town manager's appointment approved by the Board of Selectmen.
So it wouldn't be an advisory committee in the sense of the other committees that report to us, and we visit with them. Sounds like it's something different.
I think you could set it up with some flexibility. We'd have to have town council look at the enabling legislation.
And I'm not suggesting one way or the other.
I'm just trying to understand. I think you have some latitude in that.
Yeah.
I will mention, certainly one of the more interesting portions is a majority of this committee must be disabled.
Yeah.
That may not be easy to find people that would be willing to volunteer. I don't know what other towns' experience with that is, but I thought that was an interesting requirement.
Matt, did you get anything from the state in regards to that, the makeup?
Here's the general law.
No, I didn't. I looked at the law and some of the guidelines from the state. I didn't call them directly because I wasn't sure if we were ready to move on that yet. I can certainly reach out to the disabilities office to see any questions that you might have, but I wanted to see first of all if it's something we were going to pursue.
Okay.
And then take it from there.
Yeah, because I agree with Bobby. And that was, when I read through this, that was a more interesting piece to it as well, from the component of what if you have a commission set up and you have nobody to join it because they don't meet the requirements of the commission.
It could be.
I was just curious to see if there's any provisions that we
this
we
also
have in the state.
Potentially runs afoul of the associate members in that you have people, primary members who have qualifications, the aforementioned.
Yeah, that's an interesting question.
And now they're not there, but the associate doesn't have that qualification, so how do you hold it?
Okay. Well, the other question is, how do you define a disability?
Is that a person who is receiving Social Security benefits?
Is that a person who's got a placard? And that's a temporary or permanent.
Right.
I mean, is that a person who has lost a limb? I mean, you know,
right.
I mean, it's what it says up there.
Pretty
broad.
Is
in the statute.
I mean, it kind of is fuzzy. I mean, you're really not sure what it really means.
How would you?
I love the idea of it, frankly, but
how would you ascertain if you can't ask the question of somebody? You know?
Yeah, it's a tricky situation. I'd probably get some guidance from the disability office in the state and see how that's usually handled. If you want me to do that, I can certainly do that.
Yeah, do you have time to do it between now and the warrant closing?
Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah, okay. Yeah, I can give them a call.
You probably want to make sure we get this right.
Because that's 30 days out.
It's not that far out.
It's soon.
Well, yeah, no, I could give them a call and see. I don't know that they what answers they may have. They may even direct us to our own counsel, but I can call, and we can certainly get town council involved, too.
Very good, Bob.
And if this is something that town council says slow down, then we'll slow down.
Right, yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Right, but you asked me to look into it, so that's what
I said. Is this new?
No.
So somebody's got experience.
Oh, yeah.
Somebody's
doing
this.
Oh, yeah, no, it's been around since probably the ADA has been around. Yeah.
Typically in cities.
Cities, there's provisions for cities. Like we had it in Methuen when I was there in Methuen.
Yeah.
We had disabilities.
That actually makes sense.
Yeah.
Can I just add something?
Sure.
When the ADA came along here in the Commonwealth, the communities within the Commonwealth, depending upon size, actually, were given the opportunity to determine if they wanted an ADA coordinator or if they wanted a commission on disability. Generally speaking, mostly the cities chose a commission on disability. And that then followed additional statutes such as accessibility. Statutes here within the Commonwealth, the creation of the Architectural Access Board, for example. Their statutes require notification if they come in and review any matters within a community to contact a commission on disability that exists in the community. And their statute doesn't read to contact the ADA coordinator. So they generally, you know, need to have that contact as well as with, say, the building inspector. And that type of thing. But those are the two options, and you know, I think it's important as we move forward with more economic development along the way, if you will.
Other comments? Okay, you have what you need from us?
Yeah, I'll contact the state and town council, get some more answers, report back.
Okay. Excellent.
Thank you.
Thanks, Matt. Okay, it now gives me great pleasure to welcome our new about to be appointed officially police chief, Mark Sagala. I was privileged to be part of the selection team. It was a long process, but I think it's produced an excellent result. I witnessed Barry and I and Bob, the assessment center. I can assure you the chief went through some tough exercises to get to where he's sitting right now, and he performed admirably. So I have every great faith that he'll be a great chief. So. Welcome, and board have any comments at this point? Yeah, Barry.
I would just like to second that. I also participated in the process from reviewing the initial resumes, calling through them, and witnessing the assessment center. And the assessment center, if any of us actually had to go through that as a way of becoming actually a member of the Board of Selectmen, I don't think you'd see anybody sitting there.
They don't pay me enough.
I want to reassure the community. I know that usually when you do a broad search and you wind up hiring the local person, some people say, well, how did you really look at it? I want to assure everybody in this room and out there that Mark performed unbelievably versus the other competitors in this, and just sort of these assessment exercises were grueling. I wouldn't wish it on anybody, and Mark performed like it wasn't even close. So I just want to assure everybody that yes, we're recommending the local guy, but the local guy was by far head and heels above everybody else. So I just wanted to put that out.
So it's nice when it works out that way.
Yeah.
So
thank you.
Any other comments? Okay.
I got two votes. Let's see.
We have to work for every one of them. We have a motion, Mr. Secretary.
Move that the board confirm the town manager's appointment of Deputy Chief Mark Sagala as the next Reading Police Chief.
Is that motion seconded?
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? The vote is 5-0. The motion carries. Chief, congratulations.
Congratulations.
thank everyone for the support. I'm going to do the best I can for the next 10 years, and you got me. I got at least 12 years minimum to go. But I want to brought my wife tonight, and I got to thank her, because without her, I probably wouldn't be anywhere near where I am right now. I'm going to say that. So thank you again, and I look forward to see you on the 12th for the swearing in.
You keep saying smart things in public. I
mean. She'll probably tell you don't do the same at home. Thank you.
All right. Let's go back to personal appointments. Yep, we get a quick report from the chair of the volunteer appointments.
So earlier tonight, both John Halsey and myself interviewed actually two candidates for the volunteer appointment subcommittee. One was Jeffrey Evertson, looking to be a member of the Climate Advisory Committee, and Seema Lynch, looking to be on the Human Relations Advisory Committee. As of right now, for the Climate Advisory Committee appointee, Jeffrey Evertson, we don't currently have an appointment to make for him, because the we're told there's an associate member who's going to be stepping down, but has yet to do so.
Okay.
So we don't actually have a vacancy to fill for Jeffrey tonight. We talked with him and explained kind of the process. And we're going to get in touch with the chair of that committee to confirm that.
Bob, are we up against our limit of associate members on that committee yet? I don't think we are.
I don't think so, but I better check.
That was the other question.
Yeah, we had some questions. There's a total of 8, 5, and 3
at
the moment. And I think that may top it out.
Oh, 5 and 3.
That 8 would top it out if that's what we are.
There's
we
5
haven't
and
had
3
a resignation.
And
we
you know,
had a formal resignation.
Okay.
We're told the gentleman's moving to Florida.
Okay.
Somebody's moving. So
okay.
But,
so,
and we did tell him he wouldn't need to revisit us. I mean,
all right.
We
correct.
Had
we can,
yeah, okay.
Excellent conversation
make,
with
make
him. And
do yeah, note of the fact that Jeff's been interviewed. Actually, know him from way back. We worked at the same company together for a while, and he certainly is. We'll put him on at the appropriate time without any further need to come in.
Yeah, exactly. And we told him that we'll follow up with the chair to make sure that is the fact that somebody is stepping down. And if so, explain them how the process in which they need to go about doing so.
And you want to say a few words about Seema?
I do. So Seema Lynch, for the rest of the board's knowledge, is not only going for a position, volunteer position for the Human Relations Advisory Committee, it's also the Board of Selectmen's designee. And so this board, unlike other boards and commissions that are advisory to us, has a specifically was created with a selectman's designee, somebody that is, I guess for lack of a better term, a representative of the Board of Selectmen on the committee, an appointment on the committee.
Is this
so,
the only appointment we make? Yes. Or do we appoint the whole group?
You appoint the whole group, but it's interesting that there's
someone
designated as the selectman.
Actually,
I'm the liaison for that committee, but we also have an appointment. So we have both a liaison from the board, and then we have a designated member who's appointed with the board's.
Yeah. Liaison doesn't vote, but the
kind of like the CAB.
Yeah.
I was thinking of that in RCTV. You appoint 2, the schools appoint 1 out of a bigger
board.
Into
the Burbank. Yep. Ice Arena Authority.
Okay.
We have a person that actually reports to us on an annual basis.
Right.
So
right.
Yeah.
We were clear with her about the fact that there would be a special relationship between her and the Board of Selectmen, given the vacancy that's available. And it is the only vacancy available on that committee.
She would be a voting member of that board.
Oh yes, she would be.
Okay. Is she here?
She is not.
No,
here.
I think she had gotten.
We didn't. We told her
either.
She didn't need to be here. But as you look at her resume, and I'm if we were out combing the countryside for a person to represent us, I think that all roads would lead to this candidate.
I couldn't agree more.
She's a lawyer that has very strong background in related topics.
Mm-hmm.
And where that committee is, you know, as of right now, trying to find themselves, so to speak, you know, she really would fill a good role as a selectman designee.
I think she's going to be she has the ability to, and particularly upon interviewing her, she has the ability to be a very steadying influence as they go, as they're processing, should we be a public committee or should we be a private committee? I think she can be a lot of help to them in that regard, and is very interested in the topics that are tied to the mission. So,
yeah.
She was an excellent candidate.
She was an excellent candidate, yeah.
Good. All right, so we'll just do the one appointment tonight, I guess. Would you like to read the motion?
Move that the Board of Selectmen accept the recommendation of the Volunteer Appointment Subcommittee as follows. Seema Lynch to a position on the Human Relations Advisory Committee with a term expiring June 30th, 2018.
Before that, seconded. Bob, does that need to say Board of Selectmen designee?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
As the Board of Selectmen designee.
Seema Lynch to the position of Human Advisory Committee as the Board of Selectmen designee with a term expiring June 30th, 2018.
Is that seconded?
Second.
Okay, further discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? The motion carries 5-0. Seema is appointed. Thank you. Can we do the shared assessor really quick?
Take a minute or two.
Yep.
You have in your packets an agreement. The Wakefield Board of Selectmen approved it unanimously last night. There's no reason that you shouldn't go ahead and do the same, and I would rarely tell you that. This is an agreement and an arrangement that's worked out as perfectly as any two towns can share an employee. The employee in question has exactly the right personality to believe that each town is his boss. He's got us both fooled. Neither one of us is his real boss.
Right.
Victor's done a great job. Backtracking a few years, our assessing function had a lot of challenges, both between the elected board at the time and the staff, and things could not have possibly worked out better. So I'm really pleased at how things have worked out. You know, one of the best things about some of the functions of town government is you don't think about it very much, and that's where this has now evolved.
That's great.
Wow. That's
fantastic. Yeah, we had great support from Victor on the classification.
That was
yeoman service.
Incredible data he gave us.
So okay. We're asking you to approve this. Wakefield actually requested 3 years. I had suggested two. I didn't have a problem with three.
Mm-hmm.
There was pending legislation at the state level, which is why we did not do this a year ago. That legislation has died off, so we may as well go ahead and do this.
Okay. Motion, please.
Move that the Board of Selectmen renew the intermunicipal agreement between the Town of Reading and the Town of Wakefield for the Director of Assessing Department, effective January 1st, 2016 to December 31st, 2018.
You want that to be 19? Is that your proposal, Bob?
No, it's 3 years.
16 to 17, 17 to, you're right, thank you.
Yeah, I had trouble with that too at first. The Wakefield attorney corrected me.
Thank you.
That's seconded.
Second.
Okay, discussion, questions? All in favor? Opposed? Motion carries 5-0. And non-alcohol licenses and special permits. Well, we have a couple requests for early openings and 24-hour operations and some special things around New Year's Eve. Is this?
Yeah, and I would suggest with the motion that you allow all alcohol license holders to open late, because we don't know what other requests may come in, and you're not meeting again between now and mid-January. I asked both chiefs, actually all three chiefs, we have the unusual circumstance now, and they've been perfectly fine with this. They didn't see a problem at all.
And this gives you the discretion.
In the past, the board has approved serving alcohol till only 12:30.
Yeah.
I didn't see a problem with 1 o'clock, and neither did the chiefs, but that's up to you.
Okay.
Are these in just the restaurants, or is this the package stores can stay open
too?
Or just the restaurants?
Okay. Yeah, serving.
So do we need to change this motion at all? Is it okay?
I think it's okay.
Yeah, it's got the term all written into it.
All right. So, want to offer it?
Move that the Board of Selectmen extend the time to serve alcohol and food for all restaurants subject to the town manager approval from 12 midnight to 1 a.m. on Friday, January 1st, 2016.
That's seconded.
Second.
Okay. Discussion? All in favor? 5-0. The motion carries. Thank you. Okay. We're now moving on to the Birch Meadow Master Plan. We're also going to be discussing the lights. Could I ask the Rec Committee to come forward, take the front seats here?
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I would love to introduce the Recreation Committee.
Absolutely.
This would be a good test. I'll start firstly with someone that's not on the committee but tied into the committee, Jennifer Fiorente, who is our newly appointed Recreation Administrator.
Thank you.
Our sitting chairman is Ms. Kate Kamina, sitting in the front row. Ms. Nancy Lynn Swain, Ms. Emily Sisson, Ms. Jean Borowski, who serves as our school committee representative,
okay.
Mr. Dan Foley, Mr. Michael DiPietro, and Mr. Rich Hand.
Mm-hmm.
Did I miss anybody? I think I got everybody. Rich is actually going to co-present the first presentation. We have
what,
two presentations.
What I'd like to do, if it's okay,
sure.
Can we do the master plan first and then, because
sure.
I think the lights are going to take an extended discussion.
Sure, that's perfectly fine with me. Yeah. I was going to invite Rich up because Rich is serving on the subcommittee along with Mr. Halsey as two of the members helping us move this process along. So we've actually put together a little presentation, and I'll ask Rich to come on up and join me. So you'll remember back in 2007, you all know the history of where the Birch Meadow Plan was and is in the current state. About a year and a half ago, the town manager asked the Recreation Committee and the Board of Selectmen asked the Recreation Committee to go back and take a peek at the existing plan. We had capital money coming up in 16 and 17, and we wanted to make sure we looked at it and made sure that the things on the current master plan were still wants of the community, needs of the community. You'd be amazed on what happens in 5 years and how things can change, and we've certainly seen that. We have things such as playgrounds, water parks, skate parks, multipurpose courts that were on the previous plan. Some of that looks like it may be on the 2016 version of that plan. Some of the stuff has become passe, and a lot of it's because there are obviously trends in the recreation industry that shift from one place to another. So we're in the process now of collecting data. I'll speak a little bit more about that later in the presentation, but we hosted a very extensive survey over the summer, and Rich Hand has prepared some slides that he'd like to share with you about some of the results and some of the primary information that we got back. We got a lot of good hard data, hard to quantify, a lot of comments from folks, very valuable, really hard to quantify on a graph, but I think Rich has done a very good job of kind of capturing some of the stuff onto some kind of a qualitative display. So, Rich, if you will.
Sure. I might just add a comment. Sure, from a time frame standpoint, it became very clear a couple months ago that doing something for April town meeting was not reasonable for phase two, as we had said to town meeting last April. So probably a member of the rec committee or myself will make a short report at annual town meeting describing that mm-hmm. next November is the objective to finish this project, just to put that right out there.
Very good.
Okay, so John said we took the data. The first thing we should realize is that 569 citizens in Reading filled out the survey. That's pretty huge. You think about it, that's we have about 10,000 homes.
Yes.
8,000, yeah.
Right, so, you know, 5% response rate, pretty big. So,
yeah.
So you really see that the town's engaged in terms of recreation in this community. So what do we hear from the community? First of all, you know, who's using the Birch Meadow area? First thing is adults 18 to 55, makes sense, as well as youth 6 to 11. They're the most used of the fields in the area. But then when you think about it, you know, who uses it most often are the teenagers. So that really makes sense as well from the organized sports that are played there. Now, the next question is, what are they using it for? You know, what are they using the field for? Number one is really walking, running, passive type of recreation. Then organized youth sports is the second most popular use. Playground use, so that's using the playground and other facilities are there. Ice skating is really interesting when you think about it, right? It's only seasonal, you know, short season. A lot of people use that, you know, Castine Field for ice skating. Very popular sport, tennis. Okay, likes to hear that. Then adult organized sport, you know, that's a softball there. And then basketball and other. So that's, again, that's the top line in terms of all the data that we collected. Let me go to the next slide.
Sure.
So the other thing is, you know, what are people asking for in terms of facilities? The number one facility that's consistent is restrooms. We hear that from the community as well as youth organizations. So through this process, we went on this, you know, listening tour, brought in youth organizations. We talked to the neighbors as well. Restrooms, and I think that is, you know, again, that's the number one priority for the community in this area. Walking paths as well, again, number one area. Water park. So water park is really interesting because, as John was saying, we did a survey back in 2007, right? And then in 2015, water park consistently came up as top in both surveys. Multiple court, sport court. This is an important one because pickleball. How many have heard of pickleball, right? That sport has just come on, right, in the last 2 to 3 years. Back in 07, nobody heard of pickleball, right? That pickleball wasn't even on anyone's radar.
John hadn't invented it.
Yeah, John hasn't invented it, right?
I wish I had.
So you need to, as we think about this, you need to think about in the future. So this really kind of makes sense because you can use this for pickleball, volleyball, street hockey, whatever sport's going to be 5 years from now, what people are asking for. Pavilion, another thing that really came up. I think, you know, the community really wants a place that to gather. You know, if you have an organization, you want a meeting place or a place to, you know, again, to gather. Pavilion, again, top priority for the based on the survey as well. What's the lowest? Skateboarding park. Another interesting point here. Back in 07, skateboarding was a very popular sport. So over time, eight years, not as popular anymore. So you can really see how interest has changed in terms of recreation.
Before you go any farther, I struggle with this a little bit. I assume you asked the question, what don't you want to get the stuff on the right, and what do you want to get the stuff on the left?
No, this was just ranking.
How is it that the lowest rated then with 55 is lower than the thing on the left with 38?
It's based on the response rates from the Survey Monkey, the number
what
of...
What does 55% mean then?
What is that response?
55 is lower than 38, yet it's lower than...
Was that in like a column like rated
yeah.
lowest?
Yes, exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's because of the way the survey was
right.
set up.
So you had like,
don't you like?
Yeah.
That's what I asked.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
What
it actually said was, what are you least interested in?
Yeah.
Five.
Right.
It's
yeah.
what don't you like.
Yeah. That's a good way to say it, John. Yeah.
Okay,
dog park, not a popular thing. And then a turf field.
Right. And obviously they could make multiple selections.
Yes, they could.
Yeah, they were actually asked to rank.
Because they don't add.
In order.
Yeah.
Yeah, they were asked to rank them in order.
And then we asked them, okay, kind of put it in order. You know, again, restrooms, number one, the walking path, as well as the pavilion.
By pavilion, I mean, I sort of envision kind of like in Wakefield, they have the bands thing, but also would that include sort of like, you know, serving food like they have at, you know, some of the...
yeah.
So if you have, you know, Little League games going on all day,
yep.
you have at Hunt Field, but that's sort of... parent run, but
yep.
you can have kind of a...
You have a structured way to serve the public and potentially get some sponsorships and volunteers.
Yeah.
So was that envisioned in Pavilion, or was that not...
It is, and I think that we have to have some more conversation around that, because I think we all thought about that, you know, use this for food, right? That organized sports, youth organization could sell hot dogs, soda, and pizza, and they're like you said, at Hunt Park. But this is a multiple facility. So you have different organizations. You have lacrosse, you have soccer, you have baseball, field hockey. So how do you coordinate?
How do you manage
that? And then the other thing, you know, through talking to other organizations was, well, we don't know if we have the resources to manage that. We know that the, you know, the Rotary Club just took over down at the high school. And talking to them, you know, that takes a lot of work. And the net revenue they receive from it, not a lot. So one suggestion came out from the group that we talked to was, can we bring in food trucks during that time period? So you have a baseball game, can you bring in a food truck, work out some sort of arrangement with that food truck, maybe have them serve the food? But I think there's some more conversation needs to happen with this in terms of, is it a food, or is it just a pavilion with picnic tables where people can gather, have a snack, shelter maybe because of rain or things like that.
Two of those three topics are actually maintenance questions and management questions.
Right.
How do you manage bathrooms and how do you manage
yeah.
a pavilion? And depending on if you're gonna sell food, how do you do it?
Yeah.
Rich kind of touched upon that.
Right.
It would be great if we could use the revenue of one to support the other, and maybe the revenue that comes in for food sales could maybe cover the custodial costs of maintaining a restroom.
Yeah,
so you have to
how are you gonna deal with contentions of use of the pavilion.
That's
yeah.
one of the things
exactly.
that's a challenge.
Exactly. And then just storage of the food and
yep.
all that.
Yeah, there's a lot that goes into it. You could ask the
Reading Rotary about that.
Yeah.
Tell you about it.
I think, is there one more slide? Yeah. So the other thing is, you know, we talked a little bit about this already back in terms of the plan, the 09 plan versus the 2016 plan. So what's consistent and what's out of the both of the plans? Restrooms, again, we talked about it in both. Lighted fields was popular as well. Walking path, multi-purpose court, improved parking. You know, that's an issue that we have to deal with, especially down in the Bancroft area. We have to look at that. Water splash park. So think about this is that, you know, can we develop some sort of, you know, small area from a water for kids to cool off without a lifeguard. So those are some of the things that are consistent year over year. You look at some of the things that are met out of the plan from 09 to 16. One, redesigned softball field. So if you look at the plan in 09, was, and John probably can help better with this, is that to move the softball field in terms of where home plate is. So this is it right here, right, John?
Yeah, that's the current plan.
That's
so
the old plan.
That's the old plan.
I'm sorry. Well, this is the current plan.
Yes,
we don't have a new one.
That's what's there.
This is our existing plan.
So one thing we thought about was it doesn't really make sense to redesign it and spend that money to redesign, because right now it works fine. So if you say to yourself, okay, take that money and put it towards a pavilion or the restroom, kind of makes sense not to repurpose the dollars from this to something else in the area. Same thing with, and the plan was to upgrade Morton Field. Field is great right now. John always says it's an all-star baseball field within the state. No need to really change that.
You're referring to the field conditions.
The field conditions.
Right.
Right now they have a dugouts.
Yeah,
being,
dugouts just
being there.
Right.
Again, the nice scoreboard.
New backstop.
Yep.
The
fence.
Yep.
Fence is new.
But Barry had a question.
Yeah, just to go back to the redesigning of the softball field for 2 seconds.
Yep.
I just know that that the drainage on those softball fields are very poor. So you lose valuable playing time on a sunny day if it rained 3 days before. And so has that any thought been given to that, or any quick fixes involved with that? I mean, you may not redesign the softball fields, but you may improve the drainage, because the whole idea for putting lights on something to increase the usage,
yep.
But you can't play on it because it's a puddle,
right.
On a sunny day, it doesn't make
Barry,
sense.
I think they made some progress in the lighted field because I've seen that one up close.
Yeah, they redid the infield.
Yeah.
They regraded the infield. They used a different type of infield mix there, and it seemed to have helped a little bit, but it actually made it slippery.
Yeah, now you got
a
hair on
it
because the guys are scraping themselves.
With one thing, you get the other. I think if you're going to fix it, you have to fix it from the ground, from below ground.
No.
The
other one's a problem.
The issue with those three fields is it sits below grade. It's if you look from the street, you're actually about 2 feet below grade. So we're already on a down or an uphill battle, literally. The current plan actually calls for us to fix the drainage. So I think that's something that would remain in the plan, is to recommend fixing the drainage, just keeping the fields where they are. The capital plan was calling for over $1 million to reshift everything. And the concept behind that was to get all the fencing off of Birch Meadow Drive, which is a great concept, but it didn't work. Because the original plan, before the final plan was revealed, was to actually take some of Castine Field and make the whole area wider. Once we found out that we couldn't repurpose the area on Castine, it didn't make sense anymore. But it stayed in the plan because it still seemed practical at the time. As we got the cost and we looked at the cost and the practicality of it, it didn't seem to make sense.
Is there a cost that you figured out or have for doing some of the drainage work?
Not yet. There was some probably built into that $1 million that was on the capital plan. I don't know what it was. It's just kind of a engineering conceptual estimate.
Thanks.
Sure.
The last, I don't know how to say, the skateboard park, again, that was in the original plan. No public interest, so we decided to take it out. And John just talked about this last one here in terms of tree line, the walkway around
Birch Meadow Drive.
That road there. So we decided, again, didn't make sense based on we're not moving the softball fields. So that's why it's kind of out of of the 2016 plan.
So we spent some time developing a roadmap of where we've been and where we're kind of headed. So I'd like to just go over that with you. At town meeting, I had the pleasure of standing in front of town meeting and talking about the lights and hearing several times about planning and preparation and really vetting the capital money before we try to go spend it. We heard that loud and clear. And I think for this process, it makes sense for us to continue to do that. And so what we've done as a group is we've met with almost every single, I can say, besides maybe Pop Warner, we've met with everyone that is a youth or an adult sports organization in town. We met with a tennis group, we met with the YMCA. We've had just about everyone come through the door in a series of meetings that we held back in November. We spent some time last week, we sent a big mailing out to abutters of the park about a month ago, and we hosted what we called an open house last week. We didn't have a lot of people, but we had some feedback last week. We got some written notification from folks that wanted to give some feedback, so we found that to be fruitful.
Could you summarize what you heard?
Sure. Some of the things that we heard from the youth organizations is certainly bathrooms were their top priority. That seemed to be a rhyming issue for everybody. You know, they liked the idea of the snack shack, but they didn't see a real great way for us to do it. Reading Youth Baseball or Reading Little League actually proposed having their own special spot for it, as they do down in Hunt Park. Aside from having it really in the middle of the complex, they could more easily control what was coming in and what was going out. We heard about noise barriers for some of the areas with maybe some larger trees in the park. You know, if we're gonna have lights, maybe some larger trees would shield some of that. Walking paths was another big thing. Folks have talked about trying to get from one end of the park to the other. It's quite difficult to do in the wintertime or if it's rained out. So having some kind of measurable distance around the park. We've all been to Ipswich River, and I think that's something that we're headed towards, is having some way to get around the park or having a walk through a baseball field or a softball game. I think we're past those days of it being just kind of a wide open space where it's designated for a certain organization to use. So from here, we'd like to be able to go into a draft plan phase where we actually now take our feedback and try to develop an updated plan of what I just showed you and take out what we think should be changed and add in what we think needs to be added. And then hopefully by the end of January, we can get something off. I've heard we have a really great public building committee. We'd love to have them take a peek at it. We're going to have some structures in there. It would be a worthwhile conversation for them to have. We'd love to hear it. From there, a proposed Birch Meadow master plan would be completed. Have the Recreation Committee review it sometime in March. Come back to a public hearing sometime in April. We'll invite the general public back in, the neighbors, the users, to get feedback on it. And then take it back to town meeting with that feedback and say, this is what we've got. Yep. What do you think? And then after we get that feedback, we'll have town meeting feedback, board of selectmen feedback, bring that into a final written component and a finalized conceptual plan for us to start doing some capital planning. My hope is we spend the summer doing some estimating on what we want to be spending on and what makes sense. And then, as Bob mentioned, head into November with an actual nicely packaged program with comments from town meeting, board of selectmen, and Recreation Committee, and the town at large. Were there any questions?
Yeah, sure, John.
John, your final comments for ending up in the summer, kind of looking at what would be spent. As you sit here today, against the monies that were described, the $1.2 million, does that cover your full scope of work as it did, as you thought it did, in our earlier meeting?
It's hard to say because we haven't got to the point where we know
Is there anything there gives you pause or creates a problem for you?
I don't think so. I actually think there's probably a comparable amount of changes to be made. And I think there'll be, as Rich mentioned in one of his slides, there's some redirecting of funds that we'll probably be doing.
Comparable to what?
Comparable to, you know, we're reshifting the fields. Instead we spend that on doing something on another part of the park, whether it's basketball courts or we add a multi-purpose sport court. It could be facilitated to that area.
But the original scope of work that you had described to the community is still within the four corners of the project. You may have some stuff that's around the periphery that's dropped out. You're bringing some new stuff in, but the core of it's the same, yeah?
Yeah, I think the plan that you saw will largely remain the same in its at its core. I think there's going to be some changes for sure. I don't see Imagination Station being rebuilt. I think at the time, you know, in 2007, we had torn it down maybe 3 or 4 years earlier, and there were kids in middle school that remembered it, and a lot of people remembered it. I think if we were to go out and ask a lot of the public about Imagination Station, they would refer to it as a parking lot, because that's what we've used it for about almost 10 years now. So that was a ticket item. I think we had it on for $150,000. You know, that's something we could certainly repurpose.
That's an example of what you reprogram.
Right. And we'll have to reprogram if that becomes a parking lot. We're going to need money to do paving and curbing and
make it a proper parking lot.
Yeah, make it look like a parking lot.
Thank you.
Sure.
Yeah, Bob.
I think Rich is exactly right, though, that this pavilion needs a lot of discussion. Mm-hmm. And you can spend anywhere from 50 to 100 grand to $500,000 on a pavilion, depending on what it is you imagine. So I imagine that's going to be a topic for a couple nights, both for the Rec Committee and ultimately the Selectmen. You know, it's the same discussion we had earlier with the Garden Club. It's public part, you know, mm-hmm. private partnership. Who pays the operating costs? What do you offer? It's a big discussion.
John.
My experience is highly dated. My kids are older, but back in when dinosaurs were on the earth and my kids were like all, it was a perennial requirement to find fundraising sources, and food sales at Hunt Park or food sales at what was the food shack at the high school were two dependable sources. And I'd always walked away from that experience 15 and 20 years ago saying to myself, gee, if we could find a way to scale this up and do it in a way that's prudent and appropriate, I think we're mis-sized. We're not managing it well today. I think it could be grown to a more appropriate scale and frankly benefit the operating incomes of the programs that play on these fields. I'd urge us to think about that carefully, because one of the things we're always interested in is assets that generate revenue, and that strikes me as, at least 20 years ago, parents were more than willing to volunteer.
Yeah.
They needed direction. They had no idea what to do, but
right.
they were willing to work if
right.
somebody could say, you got to do A through Z, and over the course of the season, they'd do it. I think there's a way to get it done,
right.
but I'd hate to lose that thought that that's an asset that could generate recurring revenue for the variety of programs that benefit from the field.
Yeah, one of the more interesting conversations we had was with Reading Little League when they came in and said, we'd love to have a satellite shack right near our field, and then we started talking about maybe that's a better concept than having it centralized, is having something at kind of the four points of the park. And with that, you can better manage it per organization. It's hard when you have something in the center of the complex. Who gets the revenue? Who's running it? It's logistically, it sounds like it could be a nightmare trying to figure out who would be in there one night or the other selling their wares. So.
Jeff.
Yeah, I was struck with because I, as part of that, this, you know, this committee, being able to hear, especially from the Lily guys, and having had that experience, you know, my wife ran the shack at Hunt for 5 years, so I'm kind of wired into how that works, and it was a great way for money to be raised, and it was very manageable because it was local. You know, the whole pavilion idea. If you look around in places who have done a master plan, so Lexington comes to mind,
yep.
and they have a major pavilion in the middle of a big complex that is very similar to Birch Meadow. And the concession portion of it is almost never open for all the reasons that you identify. But the idea, for example, for a lot less money, I'm in a lot more manageable way of doing things. Smaller satellites could prove to be very profitable to the organization and allow them to continue to partner with the town. And that's certainly something to think about. The other thing with this pavilion, we have literally, put aside the fact we have no indoor
storage.
meeting space, okay, to do almost anything. We go to Hillview, we go to the Elks in Wakefield, we go to the Elks in Woburn, because when youth teams try to assemble, or high school teams try to assemble to have a get-together. Now, I realize in the dead of winter you can't use a pavilion, but the opportunities for a pavilion that is more of a gathering space, that has the opportunity to, you know, you've got these grills where you can cook, family reunions. I mean, one of the things that has come up many times in discussions about recreation is that there's not enough space to just go enjoy it.
Yep.
You know, that, I mean, like, do you have to be organized or at an event? And I think that the pavilion thing, because it kept popping up, I think there's an interesting opportunity there to not spend $500,000 to build it. You know, you build rain and sun shelter, you have picnic tables, you've got, you know, grills that people can cook, and now you have an opportunity for a family reunion to reserve it.
Yeah, I think concerts.
Or, you know, the Reading High School baseball team is having its, you know, its banquet that they go to, I happen to know, they go to the Wakefield Elks with 140 people. You know, and they have it the last week of June. You know, even if it rained, you'd be, so I think that there's a lot, I think that bears a lot of discussion, and it can have a very big impact on how much money you actually have to spend.
Sure.
To execute the plan.
Very good. Other questions? Okay, great. It looks like a solid plan, John. Your public process has been strong. I hope that continues.
Thank you.
Okay. John, there was some buzz in the last meeting that occurred in this room about horizontal light. Is that gotten any more play, or has that been put to bed?
We actually talk a little bit about that in the next presentation. We have some lights that are just there in your face, and they're not what we're using for lights currently isn't what you would use typically for a sporting field.
This was in the context of the proposed replacement.
But
you're in the middle of it now, it sounds like.
Yeah, and that's more of a, I think that's probably a good question for the, let's get into this discussion a little bit.
I want to set a little bit of a historical perspective here for those who may be tuning in. Lighting has been discussed on and off in Birch Meadow, various degrees, incarnations, I'm told, by very venerable town meeting members since the 1930s. The current lights that are up there have been put up in various stages and phases over the last 20 years, is that fair to say?
Sure.
Bob was prepared last fall, I believe, to bring a proposal. I just reviewed the town meeting presentation on this from April. We were going to use free cash to light the current lit softball field, the current unlit area that comprises the two fields, and Morton Field. Bob deferred on that plan, and we brought a plan to town meeting instead to do all five fields over back in April. I believe the purpose of this coming presentation is you're going to show a priority order of lighting because the funds are apparently insufficient that were voted by town meeting. And I'd like a little background from Bob or you as to what happened. Were there some assumptions made as to in-house labor that was not provided, and how can we recover from that possibly?
Yeah, that's actually the crux of the entire conversation. Thanks for setting it up, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate that. You know, we last year spent some time in November collecting some quotes. We got a very nice quote from one of the leaders in the industry. At the time, we were looking at four fields or four areas. We weren't looking at the fifth area was added late, and I think that's part of the reason why.
Yeah.
The Little League field was added in late February, right before we went to FinCom with the request. And the reason it was added is because we went to them and said, is this something Little League would benefit from? And they said, yes, they'd like to be included. at that time, it was, as a practical matter, we were letting everything else. It seemed not to make, it seemed to make no sense at all not to throw that into the mix. At that time, I had conversations with the company that had given me the quote, and they said it would be very, very tight, but it may work. We got standalone quotes on each of the five areas that we're looking at. So at the time, we were looking at hopefully a savings of some kind of an economies of scale. If we buy 2, 3, 4, 5, we're hoping to get the project in.
But in those estimates, was there an implicit amount of town labor that had to be expended?
They didn't specifically say.
Go ahead, Bob.
I can talk a little about that, and John can give you some comparables. As we stand here today, there's $165,000 of site prep costs, I'll call them, but I'll read from the list there. About $35,000 for borings, which have been done. About $35,000 for geotech work, which is still to be done. $25,000 for design work. $45,000 for irrigation repair, to answer some of the
And who's, are these being done by contractors
is,
or in-house?
This is in-house estimates of what would cost to do all these components. And then lastly, about $25,000 for contingency. So, you know, John can tell you what happened in Norwood, but as background, our current estimate is $165,000 for site prep.
Expended to date?
Not expended to date, but necessary to complete the project.
Right.
Only 35 have been expended.
Before we put up the lights.
Was that assumption that the town was going to sort of provide that, or was that
the assumption
not
I,
discussed? Or was
the
it
assumption I had going into April town meeting was a figure close to $50,000 for all that, and now it's $150,000.
So what accounts for the growth?
So why don't you talk about Norwood?
Well, we discovered that another community did a project similar size, scope, and from a financial standpoint, and they reported back that they carried about a $45,000 site design and site development for their project. So I did speak on the phone with their superintendent today, their superintendent of Parks and Recreation, and he said they actually hired a firm to come in and do the whole project for them. And they handled it pretty much soup to nuts. Now, I went back to our own engineers and said, there's a pretty drastic difference, can you explain? And they feel like there are some things that are built into their 45 that were left out. So there's still a little bit, I just can't believe that it's a quarter of what we're paying. I just think it's a high estimate. Even if our $50,000 guesstimate, and again, it's a guesstimate. I'm not an engineer. I don't try to pretend to be one. But when I think about $45,000 or $165,000, I see there's a giant difference, and I have to believe that there's something in there that someone's missing. I there's not a lot to. I was told that the quotes that we had were turnkey when I got the quotes, so I didn't believe that. Besides borings, I thought borings were the only real expense that we would see.
I'm confused.
Yeah. So where is
it? I'm very confused.
Yeah.
We got here basically our engineers changed their mind. So they gave us figures last spring that were in the $50,000 area, and now when we're actually going to the project, they're saying, oh, add another $100,000.
So how can that be?
Well, I just read you the list, and the list that last spring, they can't explain how they gave us $50,000.
Can they explain? And do they still work for us?
As of 5 o'clock tonight, they did.
Well, they should check in the morning.
Does the list they gave us today hold water? In other words, it sounds high to me. It sounds very conservative, just in case. We don't want to underestimate. You know, on the size of this project, that $165,000 on a $140,000 project to have a $25,000 contingency is very high.
Yeah.
But it doesn't break the bank. $45,000 for irrigation. They can't discuss what that means, but they said you never know what you might find. So it's wet down there, we know that.
The fields are all
they're all
every
irrigated
field except for the turf field area.
If someone putting in light poles was to do a horrifically poor job and wreck all the irrigation we have, you'd need to fix it. And that's what that number suggests, which is foolish.
Yeah, but they also have a insurance policy.
This doesn't sound like a credible scope.
No, the 165 does not sound credible to me, but like John, I'm not an engineer either.
But you said that Norwood went out and did the whole project turnkey with a contractor, and their numbers
suggested the small, you know, the
right.
smaller thing. Have we actually, what, obviously, no, I know we haven't gone out and bid it yet. So I would think is, you know, is there any way to kind of get a third estimate in, you know, someone else?
How about a real estimate?
A pair of eyes that will look at this and
apparently
just sort of say.
We won't
something
get that
Barry, that's interesting. I mean, I've dealt with a lot of vendors in my life and a lot of contractors in my life. And every time they didn't want to do the work, the number
high.
Came in four
yeah.
times higher
right.
than it really was.
Yeah, that's
well, why is our own town engineer? They're not
that's
doing
a
the work.
Question.
They're not they're doing the work. They're.
Well, let's separate the issues. There's a project here that's partially launched. We've got to figure out if this scope of work is reasonable or not. We've got to find an independent source to assess that and determine where we are in the budget. The other issue is, which is how do you deal with the in-house group. That's a separate, equally a linked problem, but it's a separate problem, and I would deal with that
problem.
Separately.
Yeah, that's my problem.
Is there subject matter experts we can have come in, and if not a quote, at least give us rough order of magnitude, kind of the same assessments you've already got, but with people that have an interest in potentially giving you a right answer as opposed to not wanting to do the job?
Sure.
And I think the approach that John took in the spring was the correct approach. He got good numbers. Anytime you do this work, you never know what real bids are. I mean, we understand.
Of course.
That. You know, with our sewer rehab projects last summer,
way high.
We had good background. Bids came in 70% higher. So you just don't know what
don't
the market
know.
Will bear.
You don't know.
Well, they could have been busy. They wanted a bigger job.
Yeah, and whether that experience and others on paving have influenced our engineers to suddenly just all of a sudden launch all the numbers higher. I've had the same discussion with them and left the same way John has, just scratching my head saying, huh?
But the number you have might be the good number. You just don't know.
We don't know, and that's what we won't really
and
know
we have
until
to determine a scope of maybe leaving something out
well,
yeah. based on
so that's
information that we that may not be right.
You come up with contingency plans.
Well, right. And obviously, if we had thought there would be 165 or even had any hint of it, we'd have asked for 1,000,001.
And
no
you
would have
got it.
Yep.
Yep. But they can't go back.
But we can't go back.
Is this, I mean, I know it's not a building, but is this something that would fall under the aegis of the building committee? Certainly have expertise there. Or maybe another pair of eyes, another.
This is pre-existing conditions, though. You don't know until you walk.
Not so much. I mean, I did discuss this with the last permanent building committee meeting. They're very interested in helping us however they can, which
yeah,
is great.
They're extremely.
I don't think this work is, I think this is outside their experience.
Right. Okay.
Some of the borings in geotech, yeah, but the rest of it, no. I mean, again, you're guessing that $45,000 of irrigation, disruption will happen.
Which is essentially replacing the whole irrigation system.
Yeah, oh yeah, I'm sure it is.
Only if you hit an oil well.
That'll take care of it, so we get that. So I'm not overly concerned it's really going to cost $165, but it raises the question, what if it does?
You're flying blind.
We have to have a priority list of fields, because all of a sudden there's at least some question. We can do all five fields. We don't know. Whereas last spring, it seemed like an easy thing, because we always build in. And I always tell them, build in contingency.
Mm-hmm.
Throw in an extra amount, because you just don't know what might happen. We can always turn money back. And usually we did, historically. Not so much lately.
Okay.
Can any of the one-time money sources be used to help support this?
That's a bond council question. And from what I understand, the answer is no, because this is a project. And it's been voted as a $1 million project.
It is a project.
We could easily find sources of funds that would be willing to pay for this, whatever they are. Since we went to town meeting and got debt authorization, it's a slippery slope.
So you couldn't even do things like, you couldn't even do things like, I'm going to say this badly, site prep that are supportive of but not necessarily part of the entire project.
That would be a question for town council, ultimately. And I have not gone there yet because we don't know we're in that position. But it's a fair question. My assumption has been the whole project needs to take care of itself, period. But there might be some wiggle room there. Certainly town staff labor would be free, quote unquote, if we can do work where others were going to be outsourced.
Okay, thanks for setting the table on that. Why don't you go ahead?
Yeah, no worries. Just to quickly review the areas that we're looking at. Morton Field is one of the three 90-foot baseball fields in town. The Legend softball field is our current varsity softball field, men's softball. The two softball fields next to it are actually considered one area. and they'll be lit in that manner as our proposal sits. Turf 2 is our synthetic turf field in which most of our high school and youth organizations use nightly.
And that's currently lit, yeah?
It's currently lit, yep. And then on the bottom is, we actually label that tennis court field, but we call it Little League field because it's primarily used by Little League, pretty much exclusively. So that just gives you an overview of the field. So the Recreation Committee spent more time, I've been here for 12 years, Recreation Committee spent more time on this single issue than any other issue I can recall. We spent four meetings, probably cumulatively about 6 to 7 hours, along with a sidewalk, which I think many of you went on, maybe back in July, August. I just remember there was a lot of mosquitoes there.
They were fierce.
They were fierce.
I think you bring some spray, though. That was nice.
During that time, we've solicited a lot of feedback from the major users of the parks. The high school athletic department and superintendent have contributed some comments. We've heard a lot from abutters. There's not a lot of them, but the ones that are impacted have been loud and clear about their concerns. So the committee thought about this and looked at this from almost like a Rubik's Cube perspective, every angle possible. They played with it. I can say that I've seen the room sway and change minds and arrive at different conclusions. And I think one might take the approach that, gee, you probably start with the ones that aren't lit in your work that way. You may look at what you have as broken and fix that and work the other way. So there's a number of different ways they could look at it, and I think those were all examined. As we spun through this, we decided that it would probably be best to find some goals and some principles, and that's when we came up with the guiding principles of usage, which is basically a current and historical look at in-town demand. We also consider scheduling and maintenance with usage, because those all play into the usability of that particular field. Safety is fixing the current issues that we do have. Everything that we'd be putting up new would be basically designed for the safest play possible. Cost has to be a consideration. Unfortunately, they're all not the same cost. They all have different prices because they're different sizes and have different aspects to it.
You also consider revenues from additional play hours in your criteria?
Nope. The last criteria was actually the aesthetics of the area.
You did not consider revenue?
No, the Recreation Committee did not consider revenue. They considered that in a different realm. They actually raised field fees back in October. They increased field fees by 20% back in October as a holdover, with the thought that if they need to go back to the table, they could do that again.
Mr. Chair,
go ahead.
When I remember at town meeting, one of the kind of selling points of this was that it would ultimately pay for itself. And so, not considering revenue, if you're going to sort of target fields, we're going to do not considering revenue. I think you need to maybe go back and revisit that, because I think the expectation of town meeting was that
absolutely
ultimately this was going to pay for itself.
I just listened to that tape and it's clear as the day.
So I think maybe that's worth going back and relooking at if there has to be priority. I'm still not sold that we have to, that we're not going to do all five. But mm-hmm. if we can't,
right,
then I think revenue should be another category.
Yes, John.
Another question, John. Your first topic, your first filter is current historical in-town demand.
Mm-hmm.
But the whole motivation here was to create new demand or support new demand. Not we're trying to grow what we have, not support necessarily what we have. And I don't see that up here. That goes to Barry's question on revenue, but it also goes to kind of utility.
Yeah, I think that's how we've looked at it. And I think that's how the Recreation Committee saw it, was we're looking at current historical, but how can we best use what we've got? And what do we like based on what we have for numbers across the board, per organization, where do we get the most impact?
But I don't hear you saying, how do we get greater use of the field in this effort? I hear you saying, how do we support the current use better? But I don't hear the words that say, how do we get more of what we already have? That's what I'm poking at. And that goes to mm-hmm. Barry's point about how do we support the incremental revenue that's going to support this.
Mm-hmm. And the incremental demand. Unmet demand.
Why don't we keep going back?
Okay,
it's just surprising that it's not there.
Sure. So we included aesthetics, and a lot of people probably think aesthetics isn't a big deal to think about, but that's something that we also talked about at town meeting, was
right,
trying to clean up what we have down there. And I did put a picture in just to show you what we've got, and you, I know you saw it in your packets.
Yeah.
The picture on the left-hand side is actually our current green shed with the lights above, and it's hideous. It's to me, it's an embarrassment.
The tires
are down below. I don't think they got quite made it in the picture, but they're there.
Yeah.
They're there, and that to me, I thought that was an important aspect, and I know that this the Birch Meadow complex as a whole is a crowning jewel of the community, so it's worth having the conversation of the importance of aesthetics in bringing in something that looks a little bit more professional. So that was something the committee talked about, and there was a lot of discussion surrounding that as well. So I'll go through the rankings kind of one by one, and you can stop me and ask questions. The Recreation Committee is certainly here to give any perspective that you're looking for. So the unlit softball fields were ranked number one. That's the two fields that abut each other. Currently has the most users. It is unlit, obviously. It's used for high school football. It's used for soccer, flag football, Pop Warner, football, youth and adult softball. It would add additional field time, and it would accommodate many, many users across the board. You know, you name the sport, we could pretty much put them on there. It would serve as a true utility field. Safety new lights would obviously give us the standards recommended for play. The aesthetics would be we'd actually be adding poles to a previously unlit field. We'd be looking at, on this area, I believe it's six poles for the entire area. The removal of the makeshift auxiliary lighting that we have there currently, which sits in next to Turf 2. It's worth noting that we received no abutter concerns. I'll go through the abutter concerns on each slide. The cost of the area standalone would be $225,000 to $245,000.
Is there a way, John, on cost, since you're talking about these as standalone, but there's got to be a common accommodated cost or a component across
economies
all
of scale?
Yeah, those out separately.
They weren't willing to quote me on a.
They won't, but can you just
base it,
again, just using kind of human logic?
If I could guess, maybe five. I would say 5 to 10% across the board would be a fair.
I'd say, but.
And
yeah, Barry.
And if you can, and I know you weren't prepared for it, but if you go through these priorities, if you can then just say, you know, what the potential revenue is, i.e., you know, which one of those users will generate some revenue, what's the potential for new revenue generated by new usage that's not currently used.
By field.
I think that would, by field. And I know you weren't prepared
for
that.
Yeah, I couldn't give you specifics. What I could do is I could kind of explain that usage is tied to participation. The higher our participation is, the higher revenue we earn on field revenues. It depends on how you look at it. If you want in-town revenue, it's going to be limited. If you want out-of-town revenue, that would continue to grow. We feel like lighting all of these fields, if you pick them, we feel that will draw interest into participation and allows organizations to grow. Right now, they're told that you can grow as big as you want, but we can't accommodate your growth. You're going to have what you have. As presently stated, with the lights, we expand our use. Some have maybe perhaps maxed out. There's only so many kids in Reading. If you start to think about inviting others into town, then obviously you have a greater potential. I'm not sure this complex is where you want to invite the out-of-town folks. You know, if there's time available, I could see doing it, but I wouldn't want to pit a Reading organization versus another organization just because they're going to pay a little bit more money.
We're building this for our people.
Yeah.
We're building this for our citizens.
Right, and so in that case, we could be limited. We feel like there is enough growth across the board when we're talking about 10% growth to 10 to 15% growth for each organization you know, over the next couple of years. And we've seen steady growth for the most part in almost every sport. So I hope that gives an overview. It's hard to really assess.
It's hard to
per
be
field.
So specific to nail it down by the field. It really is.
What other sports can you play in the softball fields, and does that limit the utility of those fields?
I'll go back there just for a second. You can play. You can already see that it's already used for football,
right,
and it's used here. And that's because we have some auxiliary lighting that's set up there. But you can see the grid that it's left. Obviously, if that field's completely lit, you could actually use the back corner. You could use it as two softball fields. You could certainly have two youth games going on at the same time.
How about lacrosse with the new lighting? Would it be suitable?
lacrosse for the new lane, yeah, they're going to tear up your grass, though.
Yeah, okay.
They're certainly going to tear up your grass because there's a lot of digging involved with that sport.
Youth soccer.
A little less concerned with youth soccer because they're playing with the ball.
The little kids.
Yeah, obviously the smaller the kid, the better off we are putting them on grass. You try to put the older kids especially on synthetic just because of the amount of damage that they do.
Saturday Night Lights.
Yep, flag football would be another. We already use it. We get by barely with what we've got. We could certainly expand. The second recommendation from the Recreation Committee is the lightest softball field, currently used by the high school for softball. It's also used for youth and adult softball, Pop Warner, and flag football. There's no extra time added here. This is more of a safety thing and an aesthetics thing that the committee looked at. So we would be set up for better vertical lighting, which would allow safer play. But to be honest with this field, it ties in so perfectly with the other two that we're doing. It would seem almost silly to have two fields relit and then have this one still look like it's got wires everywhere, because we're literally going to be running cord all the way to the other side of the field. That's where all the conduit's going to run. So to not do it, it would seem, I think, a little strange.
But this field is lighted.
It's already lighted.
It can be played.
Yes.
Today without limitation to time of day. I assume we can sell as much time on the field as we care to.
Yes. Yep.
And so there's no incremental revenue that, if I understand what you're saying, that an adjustment to lighting would derive here, other than that which we create by raising rates. Is that true?
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
So this is adjacent to the unlit softball field.
Yeah, correct.
And so you have two
between there and Castine, right?
It's this field right here.
So you have those kind of, mm-hmm. And I know you gave sort of a price, a standalone price for one or the other. Since that, you can kind of almost say that looks like one area.
Mm-hmm.
Is there, and I know they didn't do this for you, but is it safe to assume that if you did both of those, that the combined, that the cost would be less than the individual?
It's pretty safe to say, sure.
Than what you,
sure. We can bid this any way we'd like to, and that's kind of the conversation that we're trying to have is how to do that in a manner in which we get the biggest bang for our buck. So the cost of that standalone field is about $175,000 to
$190,000. What gives rise to the range, Jim? Is that your judgment?
That was actually from a professional lighting company. Actually, they're the leader in athletic field lighting. The third on the list was Turf 2. That's the synthetic field at the high school. It's currently used by high school sports, youth soccer, lacrosse, flag football, field hockey, Pop Warner. Again, we don't get any additional play time with this. What we do get is enhanced flexibility. But the bigger issue that kept on coming up was the quality of lighting. Some of you might remember in 2011, the youth organization banded together about $15,000 to put some extra lighting there. Yep. They just felt there wasn't enough. When we put those lights up, we created another problem that now we had lights 25 feet in the air glaring in your eyes.
Yep.
And if you haven't been on that field, it's very obvious. If you try to do anything hash mark to hash mark, so to speak, it is directly glaring. High school does not play any night games there currently. They will night practice there, but it's not certainly ideal for them. The youth sports do use it at night. They constantly complain about the glare and the adjustments of the lights, and they do see it as a safety issue. It's always been a concern, but it highlighted more when we did our meeting for the Birch Meadow Master Plan. We actually had Reading Youth Lacrosse and Reading Soccer come in, and they both had the same complaint about it, that, gee, it would be really great if that could be fixed. So it was really highlighted within the last month.
So is there any particular sport or sports where the danger is higher?
Yeah, I would definitely say lacrosse and football are higher because you're looking into lights that you can't see, and you're trying to mitigate someone chasing after you with a stick.
You're talking about flag football? Or
flag football would be in the same case. In fact, in flag football's case, they're going cross field.
Yeah.
So they're actually wide receivers and quarterbacks are looking directly into the light. You literally put your hand up, that's what you would see.
Yeah, go ahead, John.
Are you saying that field is unsafe for play?
No.
Well, I thought that's what you just said.
It poses some safety issues.
It says it's deemed unsafe.
I mean, if it's deemed unsafe, why in God's name are we using it?
It doesn't say it's got safety improvements. It says it is deemed by...
It's deemed by some of our users is
is unsafe.
But you chose to put that phrase on a slide, which you're presenting to the executive board of the town. We're reading it to say, gee, our recreation director is saying this is deemed unsafe. So you see why we're pausing on this one.
Mm-hmm.
If it's unsafe, we shouldn't be on the field. Full stop.
I think it's adequate for practice.
Let's
it's unsafe
the,
for
let's
game.
Let's change the slide, please.
Sure. The next field that they picked in order was the tennis court field, and the usability of that field is single user. It's Little League baseball predominantly. Additional lighting enhances their opportunity by about an estimated 50%, and that's from them presenting that to the recreation committee. Safety would be basically the same standard lighting. The aesthetics would be added poles. We'd be adding four poles to this field. Underground wiring and receive no abutter concern. And the cost of that field is $180,000 to $200,000.
I think there's some discussion at town meeting about that potentially being a multifaceted field practice out in the outfield.
Yeah, I think.
So it's not really a single purpose.
It could be used for more, and that we'd be open to the concept of putting anyone on there that wanted to use
right.
it.
Well, certainly in after July or August, I mean, there's no baseball. There's
Reading Youth Baseball or Reading Little League communicated to us that they actually have to cut their season short in fall because they don't have lights.
Right.
And it makes it hard. September and October are tough.
I think it is true that there was an interesting loss of the ability to be able to practice and teach the many hundreds of kids that are learning baseball when Memorial Park was shut down to organized practice.
Yeah.
I mean, that changed things dramatic. I mean, many years ago when that was available, I was a Little League coach. And
was that a decision?
We practiced there every night because everybody had their little corner.
Right.
And, you know, so I do understand, especially from the standpoint of being able to instruct many hundreds of kids that are learning the game and, you know.
Yeah, one of the comments that they made is they're unable to practice once their season starts because they're literally
so
into games. And that's like, that's true across the board.
Yeah, and also it's a short season, so if you get a couple of weeks of rain and you cannot make up those games,
right.
Let alone do a practice. So I would say that this is, in terms of bang for the buck, in terms of more use, that this is probably one of the biggest bang for the bucks. And then the other thing, too, you know, former Little League coach here in Reading as well, you know, we debated whether or not we were going to stay independent or join Little League, and we couldn't join Little League because we didn't have a facility that we could
right.
draw our tournament for. We now, I know Little League has built a fence, and if you add lights to that, you know, you're talking about doing a regional, you know, we can now host, Reading could host a regional Little League tournament in the summer, which would draw thousands of people. I mean, that would just be an awesome thing to do, that, and having lights would certainly add to that, because some of the other places that do have lights. So I think this would, you know, this would be a good bang for the buck, in my view,
right.
in terms of added usage.
Right.
What was
lights and a solid parking plan with the
right. And also being able to buy a hot dog. That
while we're at our restrooms.
So the cost of that field is $180,000 to $200,000 standalone.
Can I ask a question? Would that in any way be able to piggyback off the lighting system on the tennis court?
That will need to be evaluated when the electrical design is done. We're not sure if they can go right in that box or not, if there's enough room.
But it's likely to be a Musco project?
Musco is actually the provider of the lights on the tennis court, so they would know as well as anyone if it can be done.
So there could be some economies of scale if we went with them.
We hope. That's I think,
okay.
Keeping everything in the balance here. Moscarilla Ballpark at Morton Field. The usability, the use of this field is primarily high school baseball, and we do have some fall field hockey out there. I think this year it was lines of field hockey, but I'm not sure it got much use. I'm not sure we fielded a freshman field hockey team. It's communicated to the Recreation Committee that the in-town demand for 90-foot baseball has flattened out over the last couple of years. The outfield would be best used as a multi-purpose area, and I think that would be probably the biggest benefit of using that field with lights. More playing time would require us to change the schedule just because of the way baseball games are at this level are about 2.5 hours long. So if you start a game at 6 o'clock, you're leaking into at least the 8:15, 8:30 hour. So you'd have to consider some of the schedule when you're when you're taking that into consideration. Safety standards would be the same, it would be new lighting. Added poles would be 6 poles that would be going in on this field. Underground lighting, and we did receive some abutter concern.
What degree of abutter concern?
I probably spoke to about a handful of residents that directly about the park. It certainly wasn't a flooding of folks.
Yeah.
So I just had a question, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
So the time of the games, I mean, these are 7-inning games. They're 90-minute games, possibly 2 hours if they have extra innings, but essentially it's a 90-minute game.
The Babe Ruth games, I understood them to be 2 hour to 2 hour and 15-minute time slots. So.
2 hours tops.
Yeah, I think top. 2 hours is the outside.
Okay, fair enough.
That's how they're scheduled.
Fair enough.
John, the bullet there that says used as multi-purpose area, is there any field prep that you need for multi-purpose area? Do you have different grid lines down, or is there any?
It depends on how we use it, John. If we were going to use it for for flag football, you would certainly put lines down, and you wouldn't just play games with cones. If it was going to be used as a practice area, obviously you don't need as much. The thing I think about is bringing goals onto that area. If you're going to use it as a soccer area, you'd have to bring larger goals. If you're going to use lacrosse, you're going to have a set of nets in that area.
Can you get the goals in? Isn't that completely fenced now?
They could be brought in.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they could be brought in. They could go over the fence. They could be picked up and put over.
Thank you.
Sure. The cost for Morton Field would be $275,000 to $300,000 standalone. So there you have it. The priority is voted by the Recreation Committee.
Well, wait a minute.
Go from A to B. How did you get to that order, given what you've just presented? There's some logic and debating that went on here. So what was your thought process?
There was plenty of debating and logic that went on. It was a process. So the committee developed a couple of processes to look at. One of the things that they did amongst the discussion was we actually sent around a grid for each committee member to grade out in the following categories: non-existing lights, so rate it based on if the field didn't have lights going down, lowest cost to highest cost, which is obvious because it was set up, field usage, in their opinion, what deemed the most advantageous for the community, and the final one was the least impact to abutters. And they rank that based on how they thought the neighborhood impact would be affected.
Did the cost figure significantly in this ranking?
Yeah, the cost had to, because we're looking at, if we don't get all 5, how do we best do as many as we can? And I think that's why the Little League field wound up in the 4th position, is because it was one of the least expensive.
All right.
And it seemed to be something that they could swing.
Well, it seems to me this all hinges on, if you're going by cost, the costs are pretty close if your gap's only $200,000 and not $300,000. Mm-hmm. And you're suggesting that economies of scale may bring that down. Then you've got a choice of 3 other fields that you could drop out.
And the other estimated fees of $165,000.
Yeah, some of them have far, far fewer estimated
45
fees.
$45 or $50.
Right. Yeah, Barry.
I'm still sort of, stuck on the idea that it's more important to add to what we have, or add something that we don't have, than to maybe change something that's already done. And I also hate the idea that we may have to pick and choose. I'm sold on that, and we don't even know if that's going to happen. But
right.
My feeling is that the Turf 2 practice field already has the lights, and it may not be ideal, and people wish it might be a little bit better, but it seems to me that there could be, looked at certain other temporary fixes to make that glare go away, or maybe position some other things, temporary lighting, that would make that cost significantly lower, and therefore, you could, the tennis court field and Mascarella field, which currently don't have lights, move up in the order, because in this way we're going to have, one way or another, we'll have 5 lit fields, and I think that was the expectation of the town meeting when we voted, is that we're going to have lighting on 5 fields.
Mm-hmm.
And if we do have to pick and choose. I mean, what comes to me, and I appreciate the committee worked really hard at this and kind of looked at all that, but it seems we should err on the side of lighting all the fields. And, you know, that means that the practice field needs to get tweaked as opposed to putting a $200,000 lighting system in there.
Mm-hmm.
I'd rather look at that as an option than cutting out one or two of these other fields that aren't lit.
I agree. Yes, John.
Yeah, just to maybe go back to the earlier point, good is not the enemy of great. We may have good or something that we can turn into good. Maybe it's undesirable. I wouldn't say unsafe. Maybe it's undesirable. But we can make it desirable by some incremental improvements, and it's good or good enough, but it's not great. But that shouldn't be the enemy of making other areas that are unlit get some exposure. I'd be inclined to try to do something remedial around the fields that have some limitations. Maybe you can't deal with the aesthetics. Maybe that's a Project 2.0 effort that goes on in a subsequent year. Maybe we defer some elements of this scope, like the electronic controls, and we go back to the mechanicals and we get around to it and put the electronics in. But I wouldn't immediately go to, there's not enough money. By the way, nobody's proven yet there isn't enough money.
Yeah, that's the thing that I keep coming back to. We're having a theoretical discussion.
Oh, it's worse. It's worse than that. We're about to hard charge down a path, and we don't, there's a boogeyman there.
Yeah.
We don't know what we're doing.
Well, we're cutting something
but
out.
This is important in terms of estimation, this order. Yeah, Bob.
Yeah, and I have to tell you that it's a critical decision to rank these because according to public procurement law, when we go out with an RFP, and in terms of economies of scale, the best time to go out with this is right at the turn of the year.
Right now.
Now, effectively, 2 weeks, 4 weeks from now. That's where you get your best price. We must, by law, put out a list of priorities, and we must follow that in the RFP when the bids come in. We don't have to do anything. We can say we don't like the results, we're not doing anything. We've done that for projects like Overkill. But if we are going to, and we failed, had the same issue with the library. There was a list of things that were add-ons, and we had to specify in the order, if there's extra money, this is the order we must follow.
Right.
Okay.
And so there is a certain amount of strategy, unfortunately, in looking at cost. And, you know, I understand the logic, as unpleasant as it is, to say, well, we're going to miss one, it's better than missing two. That's one way to look at it. Mm-hmm. But this decision is important, and if you can't make it tonight, I suggest we don't go out with an RFP until the decision is made.
So the board would need to either ratify this ranking or come up with its own?
I would prefer the board to have an opinion, whatever it may be, and if you don't feel like you can have one tonight, that's okay. I would rather never rush something.
Well,
that's the reason why a ranking is important, because we can't do the bid and find out any of this information unless we're prepared to do a ranking.
Okay.
The ranking is put in, the RFP comes in, we come back to the board and say, well, here's the results, what do you think?
Well, it makes no sense to go round and round the Mulberry Bush wondering.
John.
Right. Is there a way to construct some what-ifs? We don't have all the data to know what we will do, but yet we'd like to go forth with an RFP that describes what we might do. Is there a way to cast this in the form of, here's our priorities. If the spending is such that it allows more work to be done, here's the order in which we wish to have it done, which may change based on the amount. In other words,
that's
the order
change. Part's what you can't do, because
right.
That would be ideal.
Yeah.
Is just approach it from a business logical standpoint and say, here's the numbers, here's the money we have, what do we do? We can't do that. That's a violation of public procurement law, for better or worse. So the list has to be made, and it has to be definitive before you know what the information
is. Let me ask one more, maybe to help others in the television audience. Hypothetically, we have turf 2 remediation and turf 2 renovation.
Mm-hmm.
Is it possible to put both those in as alternatives and pick one of them based on the funding later on?
Yes, I would think there's a way to word that.
I'd say that again.
That's a Ray Miaris question, but based on my experience.
Imagine for a moment one of the options is we do a remediation effort to address the biggest evils on one or more of these fields. But if other circumstances come to pass, we don't remediate, we actually renovate the grand scheme that's been described here. Can you construct that in a way that allows either of those to be taken so that it's already pre-wired based on the money, and then it's out of our hands, but you get one or both, and you're going to win. You're going to have better than what you have now in either case.
You're thinking of that applying to turf too?
Right, hang on.
The way you would word that
from my limited experience is the other four fields are the project. Mm-hmm. Turf 2 is an ad alternate.
Yep.
With two costs. One is the small cost, one is the big cost. And then depending on how much money is left, we can go through the menu and choose. Mm-hmm. I'd want to run that by town council because that last part's a little tricky, but ad alt mm-hmm. is definitely the right answer. The question is, can you have flavor A and flavor B, and it's so simply, my guess is that's not so easy.
You called it ad alternate?
That's what it's ad called. Alternate. So that if there's extra money available from the core bid
yep.
for four fields, so you then just, we did the same for the library. We had a list of five things, yep. like the Porco share was ranked first.
Jane, do you have any opinion on that?
That's exactly right, what he said. That we'd have to have
she
the...
Hate to say
that. She told you what to say.
Probably.
I'm not sure the tricky part is that last of how we would say,
yeah.
you know, we have X amount and then, you know, one or the other, but we could do that at all to the end.
Okay. Well,
quick question for Kevin. Now are we going around with town meeting as approved?
No, we're prioritizing.
No, you're prioritizing.
They said $1 million do lights.
We want five.
You said we could do five courts. Now we're saying maybe. So we're saying here's the best we can do, and here's the order.
They said give me five courts.
Yeah.
Here's and now we're saying here's the implementation plan.
Yeah. And I understand that we have to make a priority list to go out with it, but we're also making on two assumptions: one, that those that number of 165 is real, and two, the town meeting mm-hmm. wouldn't give more money. Do all five.
Well.
Yeah, and the reason you're seeing this now is we do this all the time. The numbers are close enough to be a problem to ask your opinions.
Mm-hmm.
There's other recreation and other projects where we've sat in staff level, ranked things, out we go, bids come in,
yeah.
oops,
yeah.
we figure it out. This is kind of a bigger deal. Kind of needed your input and it needed the recreation.
Right. Is it worth going through the exercise board?
Yeah, we have to. Let's get it done
okay.
tonight.
All right.
I think that's a great idea. That, and I think what's prioritized on there, unlit softball, lighted softball, tennis court field, Muscarello, would be my ranking. And then you take out.
Tell you what I'll do. We're going to go through. We'll go through each of the 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, and we'll entertain discussion on each and see if there's a consensus. Number one, is there any lack of consensus on the unlit softball field?
So why don't you, do you have a list? Why don't you make that number one?
Yeah, I'm keeping a list now. Is there anybody who objects to that being first? So let's, I'll entertain discussion on second place.
I actually consider doing the tennis court field. I think you're going to pick more of the youth up.
Tennis court field would be my number two.
Okay. And Dan, just as a suggestion, you might want to start before you get that, start with the other end of the list, just as the earlier presentation said, the most liked and most disliked. Build a list from the other side as well.
Well, you're getting complicated.
He's only got one PhD.
Yeah. All right, Kevin?
I have no problem with tennis court being second.
Hey, Barry?
Yeah, I mean, 2 and 2A.
No. 2 and 2A.
Yeah, I mean, between the lighted, softball field, I actually, on the aesthetic and the safety part of it too, I mean, that is just the worst looking of it. So, you know, whether that's 2 or 3, or the tennis court is 3, fine.
We'll get there in a minute.
We're saying tennis court 3, I had 3. It looks like the consensus is 2 for that. All right, so we'll take unlit and tennis off, and position 3. So we have lighted softball, turf 2, and Muscarella. John?
I'd actually put turf 2 at the end of my list as the adult. That is, I hope to get it in.
All right, maybe that's the easy one.
This is why I said build it the other way now.
Yeah, yeah.
It's easier to answer.
It's faster. Yeah.
All right. Well, that's the one. That's clearly the one we're doing, the adult.
Well, that's a perfect candidate for it because it's half built.
Let's set 5 as that.
So
turf 2 is 5.
Adult.
I would concur that turf 2
that's
is fine.
Unanimous. So we're just debating 3 and 4.
Right, now it's just down to 3 and
now
4.
Now it's between the lighted softball and Muscarella.
And I'd be in favor of Muscarella being 3 only because it's got no lights, in the lane.
Right? Yeah, I would have to agree with that. I mean, lit versus unlit.
Barry?
Muscarella 3. I would have it as 4, but
I think you get there anyway. Even
we were thinking alike, but I think it's clearly the. So lighted softballs for. So let's take a motion on, vote on the motion. Move to rank in this order. Unlit softball field one, tennis court field two, Mosquerella ballpark at Morton field three, lighted softball field four, and turf two practice field five with the alternative wording in the bid. Is there a second to that?
Second.
Further discussion? All in favor?
Is this a consensus vote, or is this a determination vote?
It's the determination vote.
Public opinion? You're sure it's just short-circuited all the hard work these folks have done. Respectfully.
I think we talked that out pretty thoroughly.
Mr. Chair,
John?
With all due respect, the work this group did was to come with a full proposal.
Yes.
We don't have that anymore. We're now into a contingency planning. I understand that opinions differ, but we've been asked to rule on a decision that we don't want to make, but we're going to make it differently because we do see it differently, and there isn't enough money to get it all done. It's not besmirching the work that's been done.
Right.
Everything is still up there. We're only talking about the order, and as we said earlier, it's not even clear there's a problem.
It's not even a problem.
We hope there isn't.
And all we're doing is setting up in a way that lets us meet the Jan 1 date, that gets it in the right priority. So without any, we're not trying to cast aspersions on any of the work. This is one of the strongest areas in Reading government is our rec department. And all we're trying to do is make sure we get as much done with what we have in a way that once it's wired and it goes to bid, we've still got all the outcomes. We can, even though it's out of our control how much it costs, we can still get most done for what we have. One other comment, Mr.
Yes.
Chair. I want to apologize to Mr. Feuder. I was short about 15 minutes ago, and I want to publicly apologize.
All right. Just call for the vote. Any further discussion?
I'm sorry. Can you just go through it again?
Yeah. Unlit softball field one, tennis court field two, Mosquerella ballpark at Morton field three, lighted softball field four, and turf two practice field five. That's the motion as seconded. Is there further discussion from the board? Jean?
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Yes.
just before you take your vote, I wanted to point out, and I'm going to invite committee members, if I'm remembering wrong, please jump in and tell me. We very quickly looked at the two softball fields almost as one, and you've got them very far separated on your priority list. And I think if you go back to the map, as a mental exercise, imagine if that fourth one doesn't get lit. Now you're going to have one softball field up there lit and the one right next door not. And from an aesthetic perspective, as you're driving along, you're going to have like tires and blah, blah, blah. And like I think, although they are listed separately, we very much viewed them as you should do these or you should not do these. But never did, and again, committee, please jump in, never did we discuss doing one and not the other. And your list has them very separate. So I'll just throw that out there as something to consider.
Okay, I'd actually rank that second personally.
Yeah.
And I have actually, in having played on that softball field several years, it's really hard in that field.
Yeah, I've kept score on that field for many games for
right.
softball.
So
I know full well
yeah.
how it is.
Yeah,
yeah you
it's
can't.
An outfield or,
it's dangerous.
It's
careful with that.
It's the most used town field.
And it's.
If it's dangerous, if it's unsafe, shut it down.
We really need to be careful when we say things like dangerous and unsafe because that has.
You can't see the ball in the outfield.
Then
really
don't
well.
Play.
Then don't play there.
It's that simple. We can't assume the risk if it's unsafe.
If you're telling us, as a member of the recreation committee, that you are sanctioning unsafe play, and you're saying that the executive committee of this town, there's only one answer to that.
So
you could say shut down Little League field because the fly balls go on the tennis courts. And I mean, it's so congested there. You could say a lot of things are unsafe there. It doesn't mean don't play on them.
No, but nobody's come before us and said shut down Little League because baseball. By the way, there's a fence or a net to prevent that.
There is. However, I've been
100%.
Playing on the tennis courts when hard balls come onto the
okay.
surface.
So we should get a net.
We should get a bigger
net.
We
have a net.
Get a bigger one.
It's
get
not
one that
effective.
Stops them.
You're going to need a bigger net.
You're waiting all meeting for that.
I was. Is there further discussion?
I mean, my personal feeling was also to, I looked at those lighted softballs off, the softball as one. And also because there's probably more of an ability to do a economy of scale because they're right next to each other. So that's why I kind of had that as, you know, kind of ranked together. I would pray that the numbers come in that we could do all four. That this is just
all five.
All five. But if not, then at least the four. I mean,
so, Bob, just because these are separated in priority, if the money is adequate, that would not prohibit them being estimated together as for an economy of scale.
I assume that if you go with four as the core and one as an adult, then the four would be bid as a package.
Yeah.
It will not be bid with specificity saying, well, this one's this one's that. It's just, here's a number.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Either the number works or it doesn't work.
Okay.
If you have enough bids, then you have a range usually. It doesn't really matter, if you will, that you've paired any of these together. Unless we don't have enough money, we have to go back to the vendor, and Jane, please jump in and say, look, well, how did you price number four? Because we don't have enough money. Does that sound right?
Yes, yeah.
But they wouldn't necessarily tell us that in advance.
No. We would then have the bid in front of us.
So you're saying it doesn't really matter how we rank the one through four?
Well, it doesn't in terms of the bid package if the bids are satisfactory.
If you have
it does money. Matter if none of the bids come in below a million. Then you have to say, uh-oh,
what
is your price number four?
Because
we may not be able to afford that one. And then they,
right.
We're at their mercy. They tell us.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, sir.
The wise philosopher Michael Jagger once said...
That Mick Jagger?
Yeah.
Yes.
You don't always get what you want.
If you try sometimes.
You get what you need.
Get what you need. I actually said that at town meeting once. Many years ago.
Just to Gene's point, I think it's a good one. I do feel strongly that if we did four out of five and weren't able to do the fifth, that the mere optics of it would compel us to, in a separate action, a meeting or two later, get it done. I'm not suggesting that's our path, but I think town would look kindly upon us doing the will of town, which is doing as much as we could get done, and would recognize that the process had issues. And we could certainly defend that as part of our discussion should that come to pass.
And just so I'm clear, we're moving forward tonight. So we're ranking these, I understand that part of it.
Yep.
What's the logic, I'll be probably risking one. What's the logic of not going back to town meeting?
Yeah, I'll go back to town meeting and wait.
It's a delay.
But wouldn't we then be going back with a price set rather than a price estimate?
Well, when the bids come in,
if we bid the whole project,
do the bids, and there's some reason you're not satisfied with the path forward, then obviously you cannot do anything and go back to town meeting.
You can always go back later, but this gives you the option to start now.
I wouldn't suggest going back to town meeting today because we don't feel like we have enough information. You've got to get that information.
There is no town meeting for 6 months.
Okay, so let me fast forward now. We go through the bid process. We come up with a bid, and you know the 50 wasn't going to be the number, but it wasn't 165 either. It was somewhere in between. It doesn't look like it's going to be a whole lot more to get that fifth option on there. Could we then go back? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Especially if we do the ad call.
Right. Well, actually, Jane, is that right? Because the time frame. So you get bids. It's a million one, let's say.
Yeah.
Right.
Do you have a time frame to have a town meeting revote the total? There's probably a time frame.
You call special in April.
You do it in your RFP. You say bids are good for 90 days.
Right, tops.
Okay. So we'd have to be careful how we word it, I guess. Which then makes bids a little bit worse if you specify a longer time frame. Hold the bid for 120 days.
Further discussion on the board? Something new, Mr. Sweeter?
James Sweeter, Precinct 7.
Yes.
So, if I understand town meeting's allocation was $1 million from free cash?
No, it was borrowed.
Debt.
Borrowed money.
Borrowed
money. And that the cost of it was going to be revenue-based and paid for by itself in a period of 30 years?
Informally.
It wasn't part of this.
It's not legal to pay with recreation fees directly, so the discussion has always been an informal one.
So I think you have, before you can vote, I think you need to understand what the revenue is in the revenue stream. Because it's based on user fees, if you increase user fees, you may not get participation.
Yeah.
I ran Morton Field, I came up with a 3-hour game at night at $236 for 3 hours. And even though they play in 2 hours, you could have the lights on for three. Or you cut back the use.
I mean, in what world does that happen?
What time do you play game? 7, 8, 9?
You play a game at 8 o'clock and the lights go off at 10. I mean, that is a standard operating procedure in all the lit fields around here.
I think that's not quite germane.
But what I'm saying is there's a calculation we can do. We can look at it. You can look at revenues, you can look at cost. You can allocate it out. Are you 20 years, are you 30 years, and 50 years? What's your expectation? It's just a business game.
John?
I think you need to do that before you make a decision how to go forward with this.
With all due respect, Mr. Chair, that's already been done as justifying this project. So to suggest that needs to be done over, I could see certainly
there
why.
There was a briefing given to us back in March covering all this.
If we go there, it calls into question the veracity of all of this.
I'll send that to you.
I'd be inclined to, unless there's a reason to change the activity proposal that was made in front of town meeting, is there any reason to change that, John?
I don't think so.
No, the only piece of information that was not contemplated is let's divide up all the revenue we're thinking about by 5 fields.
By 5 fields. Mm-hmm. That's fine.
Because here's the total, based on total usage.
So it's 4 fifths or whatever.
Yeah.
All right. So further discussion from the board.
Yep.
Hearing none, are we ready for the vote? All in favor of the prioritization as enumerated, please raise your right hand. Mm-hmm. The vote is 5-0. Mm-hmm. Motion carries.
Yeah.
Is there any further discussion on this subject or anything else on this topic?
John, again, sorry for my outburst.
And just like the whole no easy decisions are made tonight, but
sorry if I was supposed to defend you or something I didn't know.
So we're going to find out as we go forward that prioritization is going to be the order of importance.
Yes, indeed.
Sure is.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Just a ranking, right?
Break, gentlemen.
Please.
5-minute break.
the FY '17 budget. Bob, you want to start? I have something to add at the end.
I've sent out budgets to department heads today of what I'm proposing. 3.25% operating budgets is what FinCom suggested. It's been an interesting process. Some of you know certain parts more than others in terms of what has been requested. We had a fair amount of requests this year, and I had to cut over $1 million from what was requested. And much like last year I added in a request that was kind of frivolous. It was extra sidewalk money. I didn't do that this year, and I can't say any of the requests were frivolous. They were all things that you would recognize. Mm-hmm. Nothing was a surprise. You know, and I don't want to give you a list, but, you know, to balance the budget, we had to do a lot of, if you will, cutting from the requests. I'm not willing to go into great detail until January because we have to have staff meetings still, but there will be positions eliminated in this budget, and that is positions multiple. I won't speak to the schools. That information will come out soon enough. But the caution here is, and I've mentioned this to these departments, next year, a year from now, without additional revenues, we will almost for certain be looking at cuts in public safety and public works and the library, three areas that historically we have not tried to do, and particularly for public works because that's been gutted over the last 20 years. Right. Their staff is one-third or whatever what it used to be.
It was over 70 people.
It was over 100, 120.
Really?
Yeah, and now it's 40. And then public safety and the library are probably reasonably at all-time highs of staffing for community reasons. I don't think we can sustain that in a year. So that's what's come out of the budget exercise so far. So it's a little bit of a caution. It's not an urgent thing. But it does look like next year the alternative for cutting things like that is cutting programs, cutting services, or raising revenue. So I don't really want to sit here and give examples, but there are things town government does that one could rightly describe as not essential. It's a nice to have. We can't afford nice to haves. If the community has asked for more revenue and says no, for instance, you have to respect what the community says.
Yeah.
So it's going to, you know, for January, you're going to set up a year's worth of discussion, I'm sure, and FinCom's going to be your partner, as the school committee will be, in terms of how to get this information out there, to be very transparent, very honest with the community. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I would describe a budget that eliminates positions is never easy. But compared to what I see down the road, this one is not nearly as painful as what will follow. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to give you that as a background. And I'll also mention that at the Finance Committee last week, and this has come through in emails as well afterwards, their top priority is employee attraction and retention, period. Pay the staff that you need to have before you start going doing new things. Take care of your current situation. Yep. So I was a little surprised by that because employee pay is kind of a lightning rod in the public sector. But at least our Finance Committee understands that we've had trouble hiring people, trouble retaining people. Superintendent has said the same thing, and they view that as being a pretty serious issue. So, you know, hopefully this budget will address some of it, and I am proposing some funding for more pay and classwork aside from whatever the people's raises are, so we can keep looking at that. It's difficult to make that call at a time when you're eliminating positions. It seems like it's the time to start, you know, fish or cut bait. You can make everyone equally unhappy and a lot of them will leave, or you can start saying, look, this is the core services we have. The positions you'll see eliminated, I would describe as not core or overstaffed areas.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, sir.
Bob, thinking ahead to how this gets presented to town meeting in whatever format that happens, it would be helpful, and I don't know how to portray this, it would be helpful to show some sense of the attraction and retention behavior. And I it'd be interesting to know, you know, number of positions open, months open, number of candidates, some way to show the community that either the waterline of where people are willing to entertain Reading is climbing, and that's evidenced by, you know, difficulty hiring, inability to keep and I'm just describing what the message would be, because at the end of the day, it's not hard numeric data, it's just evidence of the trend on our side, on the town side. On the school side, I would imagine they have something different. They're more challenged by, I would imagine, the scope of what they're being asked to deliver grows, whether it's unfunded mandates, whether it's
right.
the feedback from the, so they've got to show that in a different dimension of we're being asked sure. to do more with the same. Here we're being asked to keep talent that's taken 10 or 15 or 20 years to grow and keep them in place, because replacing them has got a far higher cost. And I think unless we communicate that effectively, right. people don't get it. They really don't get it.
Yeah, and I will say, I think I mentioned that there were no additions to the budget. There are four positions that I'm proposing more hours for, and it's all 37.5 changing to 40.
Yep.
Fire chief, police chief, DPW director, their entire staffs, union and non-union, cool. except for clerical, are currently 40 hours, and they had been asked to supervise staffs. They don't have enough hours to match, so that's just foolish.
Yeah, but just on that, I mean, that's not really adding services.
It's really not adding
because
hours
because they're there
services
anyway. I mean, they're not
they're
going
there
home
anyways.
At 37 and a half
right.
hours.
It's recognizing
we're just paying
the
them for what they're doing.
Yeah, I mean,
well,
for instance,
almost.
Well, yeah. Whether you're
making
paying
the attempt
fairly
or
amounts,
what they're
doing,
making the attempt.
We are making the attempt.
Or what you have, you know, an assistant DPW director, and we have an assistant, a deputy chief, at 40 hours, and all the union staff at 40 hours, and then
that
we're
makes,
asking
that
the director,
makes total sense.
You know, come in for 40, but we can only pay it for 37 and a half. That's not right.
So you supervise all of these people, right?
Yeah, the fourth position is town engineer. That's he's supervising a whole staff of 40, and he's 37 and a half. So three department heads and town engineer. And yes, I do too.
And how many hours do you have
to get there?
Paid or unpaid?
I'm
paid for 37.
Yeah.
And a half.
Okay.
Yep. That's coming up.
So that's the background. It's going to be a budget discussion, which, with all due respect to everyone involved, is not going to be just focused on FY17.
Yeah.
It can't be this year. We have an FY17 budget. We need to get organized, pass it, have town meeting approve it. That's important.
Yeah.
That's not the biggest thing on the table right now. It's FY18 and 19. So, you know, the time is now. We can't. A year from now, we cannot provide the same services for the money we have.
So what I think I'm hearing you say is that although this is painful, this is, you're not cutting the mission apart.
This is the last
but
year
that's, this
of
is the last time
through.
That you can
yeah.
do something without
yeah.
it coming unglued.
Yeah, I mean, I you know, next year, to pick an absurd example, I might say we can't afford to collect taxes anymore. That's a function we have to eliminate. We kind of have a hard
well,
time paying for anything else if we did, but
we might push
those
back
are the kinds
a
of discussions that are going to have to be
I
made.
See.
Or the service we offer is going to have to be worse.
Right.
There's going to have to be longer lines at the collector's office, because let's cut half of them. I hope they're not watching. They're not high on the list to be cut.
It will bring back debtor's prison or something.
But those are the
stocks,
kinds of discussions
stocks,
you're going to be looking at in a year.
Should be no surprise to anybody.
No, absolutely.
We've been talking
no,
about
really
it.
Those
for
who have been following it.
We've
three
skated
to four
for three
years.
Or 4 years.
We've been saying that the
yeah.
time
yeah.
is coming. You know,
it will be a surprise, Barry. Because people, you know, you got to over communicate this thing. It's the trouble. It will be a surprise.
And I think one of the things that we do is that we've managed so well.
Exactly.
We've managed it
yes.
so well that the expectation is that we're just going to manage it even better.
We can manage our way
before.
Out of everything.
So
yep.
when we go and we say, listen, we're reconfiguring this and we're doing that and we're, you know, we're saving a couple of pennies here and a couple of pennies there, or we're not hiring this person, you know, it's an unfilled position, and we go to town and say, well, it's not really impacting services. Mm-hmm. So basically the message is, well, you can cut and you're not impacting services. The fact of the matter is, every time we don't fill a position, we are impacting services.
Yes.
And what we've basically said to let everybody not get fearful is that we're still going to be able, we're just going to work harder behind the scenes where you can't see it. And we're going to continue the same level of services. But I think maybe one of our mistakes, and I put that in air parentheses, is that every time we've not filled a position or every time we've kind of did it around, we said, oh, don't worry, it's not going to impact services. And I think the message should have been, well you know what? This cut does impact it. Maybe it's not as important as something else, because now we're getting to the point where Bob is saying loud and clear that we can no longer keep the level of services.
Well, and you know, you're absolutely right about everything you just said, and the other unintended consequence of this is, when you do all that behind the scenes, making it work, the opportunity to lose people, and when you want to hire somebody, the word is out, okay, if you take this job, you have three jobs.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, and you're gonna be paid less than somebody in a neighboring community.
Right.
So, I mean, those are, that's real stuff going on. I mean, most of us have had the opportunity to sit in to one or more interview sessions for a position that we had to fill. And, you know, you had a clear understanding that maybe the person who was a spectacular candidate just really couldn't afford to come here, you know?
Yeah.
Or we finally had to make a decision that we would have to leave a vital position unfilled, and, and we've done plenty of both of those things.
Sure.
Just as with the light discussion tonight, I do think we're going to end up in a position where we can't predict the outcome, and the public may easily come back and say, you know what, we don't want to do that, and we're going to be put into a prioritization exercise.
Yep, yep.
So whatever we do, we can't wire this so that it only works if it passes.
Yeah,
it's got to work if it fails, and that's Bob's point about non-essential or non-critical.
You have to have paths, you're right. You have to have A, you know, path A, path B.
So I don't want to, we shouldn't be talking ourselves to, we got to do A, B, and C, and then it would come to pass that it doesn't come to pass, and then we're hosed.
Right, by law, we have to balance the budget. So one way or the other.
At the end of the day, there's no printing press in the basement of this building.
Well, I mean, I think one of the things that has to happen, and Bob, you mentioned it a little bit earlier in your remarks, it becomes incumbent on us to partner with those people that are helping us oversee the money, which is the FinCom, and those people which are mightily helping us spend the money, which is the school committee. And we need to partner with them to take the message, a transparent, clear message, to the neighborhoods, so that people understand. You know, I mean, I have a personal preference, I think all of us would, as to which way we'd like this to work. But I think as elected officials, we have to tell the story in such a clear and transparent way that the voters ultimately will decide what they want. And they need to understand that if A is chosen, this is what will happen. If B is chosen, this is what will happen. And
they need,
C.
They need the full picture.
They do.
Yeah.
And we owe them that. We need to take this show on the road to the neighborhoods of Reading, into the schools, you know, into the Pleasant Street Center. I mean, we need to partner with those other elected or appointed officials that are the guardians of the, you know, of the money.
I'm in a little slightly different position. I think that it's probably our job and the school committee. I think the appointed committees are advisory, and just in terms of getting the message straight and the elements of it straight, we're the ones that have got to stand up, and it's got to sink or swim from us. They can help.
We need support from them, though, John. Wouldn't you agree
no question,
with that?
The support.
I mean, you know. I mean, there is a FinCom who is independently appointed that...
They report to town meeting.
Yeah. their input's important.
Agreed. It's not an input question. It's an advocacy question.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, Bob.
I wouldn't normally do this, but it might be helpful if I actually direct you to page 3 of tonight's packet and I read some of this, because this is a message that... This is the summary of what FinCom discussed last week. And what a subcommittee of 4 of them are going to prepare for the January financial forum. So they had a list of 10 topics. Inability to fill open positions, losing employees due to pay, school and towns. Understanding use of free cash and its impact on the operating budget. They're concerned that if the community sees a free cash number, that there's no need for an operating budget problem. Average tax bill, to show that Reading is not a high-priced community for tax bills versus the services. Expectations of services in the community, and we all know that that's high. Some kind of an explanation of Prop 2.5, just to explain that it's set up to ask for more money or cut services. You know, and we had an interesting discussion on Prop 2.5, that if the health insurance market were what it is now, Prop 2.5 would be some higher number. There's no
Prop
question
3.5.
About that. It may well be Prop 3.5. You know, again, for
it's
better or worse.
An interesting way of looking at it, yeah.
What budget's required for FY17 for level services, and John and I will work on that.
John Doherty,
yep.
Can I request that in that effort we use a single method to portray the answer? I'm not sure.
We'll try. We don't speak the exact
same language. I know the
language
isn't the same, but can the slides read the same?
Yeah, yes. Well, let me just throw a quick question at you. What is a level service budget? Is it to deliver the service at the same level, or is it to staff the same level?
That's two different things. They're not necessarily the same thing.
The deliverable is the service, so it's the constant service level.
So I'll need to adapt my thinking to the way the schools present level service, because it might mean I'm proposing 6 new positions in the budget to get level service, and that's not something we normally say.
Yeah, I'm back as
an exaggeration.
I'm back into the Munis discussion. So
I think that's an important
this year
part
more
of the
than
discussion.
Ever, if we have
raise
two
that.
Different languages up there,
yeah,
my head's going to explode. We got to have current year and prior year comparables and percentage differences that actually the math follows.
And honestly, headcounts where they can do it.
Headcounts. I mean, this year more than ever, if you want to lose the argument, go up there with a confusing story that doesn't hold, and you'll get
it's
it.
Over. The more transparency we get from all quarters, the better.
And the number two here, I'm nervous about, I think we ought to lead with free cash, not hide it. We need to explain free cash so that people understand it, not be afraid that somehow it'll be misinterpreted. If it's not understood, that we haven't done our job.
Is that what he meant here?
I think that's probably what he meant. Yeah, and these are no priority orders, if that's your concern.
One thing you have to show with that is it's not a free cash,
I heard
it's not
it
a stopgap.
I heard it differently when it was explained.
Yeah, I didn't explain it well. And this may cross the line a little if, you know, how much should the override be? But, you know, they are the FinCom.
Well, I mean, ultimately,
you'll decide.
Yeah.
Yeah. And
the voters will decide.
We got one data point on what could be tolerated from town meeting.
Yeah, we did get a data point.
5%.
But that was from the town meeting. That wasn't from.
And also, that didn't explain what each increment bought you.
Right.
Yeah.
At the time.
It was a
gut feel.
Off the.
It was sort of like, okay, I can afford. But, you know, if what they really wanted costs, you know, X plus two, maybe they would have voted X plus two.
But you know, it's almost
say no, deliver it for X. We want it anyway.
Right.
Just to follow up.
Yeah.
It's not a bad proxy for the man on the street who isn't going to sit in town meeting and won't hear the nuances. It's probably not a bad reaction. It's the best proxy you have to what the average voter is going to respond to.
And it's more, if you all plugged in audience that's immersed in this stuff. And they understand the ins and outs. They've sat through the budget discussions over the years, most of them.
You know, at a certain point, I think what you have to do is, I guess if I was not as close to this as I am, and I was sitting out there making a decision about what I was going to vote for, and I, you know, kind of the first reaction I would have is, government wants more money, they don't know how to spend it. Because every time I send a dollar to Beacon Hill or to Washington, D.C., I got to tell you, I do feel that way. However, I've never really felt that way locally. But even before I sat here, I actually always felt like people were trying to pay attention to not throwing the money around.
Yeah.
Most people probably feel that way.
I think many
you can
do.
See the services you're getting every day.
You know, the other. The other side of government intrudes and somewhat poisons the well, I think.
Well, you know, what becomes important is that when you say to a voter 2.5% override, 5% override, 10, pick the number. I really don't care what the number is. And you say on a zero-based budgeting basis, this is how much money that is.
Yeah.
This is where we're going to spend it. So they understand. Because it's fair. It's only fair that they understand.
Well, they have to.
And you know, and to your point, John, that you raised earlier, I was thinking about where you were, what you meant, and I probably have misspoken when I. It is up to the school committee, and the board of selectmen, to be the people on the front line, and it's up to us to rely and partner in the background with FinCom. Helping us because that's what they're working on, but we, you know, the town elects us, the voters elect us.
We're the policy guys,
and we need to be out there on the in the front line, talking about it, and you know, not necessarily selling anything, but informing them.
Yeah, this is a straight information problem.
That's exactly right. And it's more about, it's not only talking about what that's going to get, because that doesn't, if you ask me, that doesn't get you a yes by any means. I think you also have to tell the story about how you got there.
Sure.
You know, it's really yeah. two things. I mean, it's
right.
not a sell job, you know, telling the story, just showing them, here's the timeline. Here's how it all transpired. Yeah. Here's where it's coming from and going to. This is where it needs to go if you want that to continue in the future. And then you let the voters decide.
Yeah. Well, that's the place that, you know, you actually end up having them have an aha moment to make a decision. Mm. And
the aha really is
up to them.
Yeah.
You know, right.
There's
going to
be no
really
two ways around this.
Well, it's, you know, I think while we're definitely going to be the folks who are going to go out and educate people on this, you know, if there's going to be an override in town, it's got to germinate up from the community. There's got to be a group like at Melrose, although it didn't win, or like what happened when we did the high school. There was a sort of independent ad hoc group of people that came together and went and talked to them.
Yeah, there should be a ballot committee. Yeah.
And, you know, that shouldn't be,
right.
you know, and if that doesn't happen, well, then there's, you know.
We're in a very strange time in our nation's history at a national level, and the world is very different than it was 10 years ago. The hardest problem, I think, the question we're going to get asked is, tell me how it is that government goes up by more than 2.5% in an environment where my income doesn't go up by 2.5%. And that's a hard question to answer before the street light changes.
I make things work somehow, yeah.
But that's the question that's on people's minds, because I've heard it already from my neighbors, is tell me again why it goes up every year? Well, it's salary-based, there's no product. Huh? What do you mean? And it doesn't compute, because in their own world, they don't get to demand incremental revenue when their expenses go up. And here, government is saying, no, we need more out of you than we did last year.
Yeah, but tell me, what are we, 80% salaries? Less, 70?
We don't make a product. We don't.
Right,
our
right.
costs are all labor and
revenue
wage
side,
related,
yeah.
largely.
Yeah.
So
and benefits.
And
what
benefits.
We spend
no
on
cost
stuff
of goods.
Is
we're
tiny.
No cost of goods
we're
sold.
Communism.
Yes.
We're a centrally planned market. It doesn't work.
And just as all of us have had that moment where Bob says to us, like he did tonight,
I quit.
No, it doesn't work that way. You can't do that in this sector. You
right.
can, most people don't get it.
You can't borrow money to pay next year's bills.
Well, the other thing that the private market doesn't deal a lot with is unfunded mandates.
That's
we're
no
told
plumbing,
things
yeah.
to do.
Right.
And we don't have any choice. We can't let the market decide. We're told by the state or the federal government, you must now do this.
Right.
No child thing, left behind.
Yeah. The other thing I hope that doesn't happen, and I've heard it happen previously, is if you don't do this, the sky will fall. If we don't do this, the schools will fail. It's not credible. Yes, there'll be
different.
A negative impact,
yeah.
no question, but it can't be an all or nothing
yeah,
proposition. That goes to this
yeah.
concept that there's got to be
at least, is to be avoided.
Right. Well, yes. All you do is undermine your own argument when you do
right.
that.
You just need to lay out the information. You lay it out as you know, simple and cohesively as you can. And the voters can make a decision.
Let me finish the list. Long-term plans, that's a lot of economic development the board's well aware of.
Mm-hmm.
The importance of schools to sustain property values. And then I think the last one is one of the most important, is how do we build awareness in the community?
Why this order, Bob?
No reason.
No.
Just brainstorming.
I would have put 10 as one, right?
It's not a priority list. It's just brainstorming and then just listed in the
yep.
same order it was
right.
discussed.
All right.
It's actually a pretty good starting template.
Think so.
Yeah. Interesting, Jamie.
Okay. Does that conclude your
yeah,
piece?
Yeah, thank you. Sorry.
Very good.
Yep.
Okay. actually, the topic number one segues perfectly into what I'm about to talk about, inability to fill open positions, losing employees due to pay below peer communities. Starting in the fall, I began thinking, we have a town manager who's very assiduous at looking out for pay and classification concerns, keeping his folks paid as best we can afford it. So it's really incumbent upon this board to do the same for him, given that he's received good reviews. He's leading this town in a really exemplary way. Back at the financial forum in September, I on the side asked Sharon to commission a study of town manager salaries. And you see that in your first handout here before you, town manager salaries. This is the results that came back. She collected some additional data. I did start sharing this without having cross comment among board members. And they suggested some additional things they wanted to see, such as budget managed, town size, miles from Boston, et cetera. I added another column today from information Bob gave me. It's whether this is a FinCom peer community. And the salaries on this chart range from 101,000 to 189,174. And these are just town managers. There's no administrator salaries in here, just town managers. If you notice, the predominant FinCom peer community salaries are above the town manager's current salary of 149,276. There's quite a few ones in that first column. Burlington, Linfield, Andover, Belmont, Danvers, Westford, North Andover. As Bob and I have talked, some of those are recent hires, so the numbers tend to get biased higher for those who were recently hired. If you notice on the right, there are, and the second sheet actually will go into this in more detail. There's other ways of compensation that the board might wish to consider. So what I'd like to entertain some discussion on tonight, not the specifics and not in any agreed upon fashion, but just to get the ball rolling so we can bring this to a vote when we actually go through the general services budget. What's the sense of the board as to how we should perhaps consider making an adjustment? And on the second sheet, which is entitled Survey by Wilmington, which Bob just sent me today, you'll see that there are a number of other ways besides base salary the town managers are compensated. There's deferred comp, occasionally a longevity payment, that tends to be rare though. Vehicle allowances, life insurance reimbursement, vacation buyback, et cetera. So there's a toolkit that the board has at its disposal. So I just wanted to kind of open it up for some general thoughts from you, and then I'll talk about the process going forward.
Bob, what is deferred comp in this setting? What is it?
I assume it's a contribution to a retirement fund of some sort.
You have to set up an agreement.
Yeah.
An agreement between the employee and the employer, typically drafted by an attorney, and then it gets funded. And then there's lots of ways you can fund it, but I mean, effectively, it's agreed upon and then executed.
Right. Okay. John and I have sort of appointed ourselves as a subcommittee to kick some thoughts around on this. John, you had some opinions?
Yeah, I think there are several things. And when you start to look at the numbers here, you'll probably understand why, you know, I feel like we need to, and Dan and I have talked about this a lot, we need to address making some changes here just to remain not at the top of the pile, because I think that's not something that, I think if we tried to go there, our town manager would.
It wouldn't work.
I
wouldn't
speak with you sitting here. I mean,
I'd be lynched.
It wouldn't work.
You would come unhinged.
Yeah.
So
at the top of the pile on anything.
However, exactly. At the same time, we have to do what is appropriate and reasonable for lots of different reasons. We need to come into the reality of what this, let's forget. Every time you look at a job and how much you pay for it, you have to take the person and the personality out of that job.
Yeah.
And you have to say, okay, what's the job? Because if, Bob, if you get run over by a bus tomorrow, I mean, we would have to hire somebody new, much as I would, you know, I would feel sad. And I would.
I
feel
appreciate
sad.
That.
We would have
you are really a sentimental guy, aren't you?
Sad day after we'd hire someone else.
He didn't mean that. Long live the king.
But, yeah. You know, and you and I have these practical discussions all the time.
I hope it's not a Budweiser truck.
I really hope it's not a bus either.
I'm going to cry.
So when you think about, from a practical standpoint, what should the job be? Traditionally, we have not been at the top of the pile. And you know what? I think if we tried to go to the top of the pile, there'd be resistance in many directions, starting with the recipient. But, you know, we're near the bottom.
in a relative way to peer communities.
Yes.
And that is unacceptable.
I didn't realize that until I threw those in today.
Furthermore, I mean, you know, an immediate step forward, for example, before we start tinkering around much, I mean, the very fact that you have proposed that certain supervisory people in this town should be locked into a number of hours they're compensated for relative to the people they supervise. Step one is the guy that supervises them all, better get that in lockstep. So these are just a few ideas, and you know, that very move by itself, just lining things up, will be a step forward. I don't know or feel that that's the end. And you know, I've suggested to Bob, I mean, you know, Dan and I, as the chair and the co-chair or the vice chair, thought it was incumbent to have some discussions, and we have, and we've challenged him to think about what would be important. Yep. Some things are less expensive to do than others. And so I think that we really have to open a dialogue around this and get this thing in a more appropriate sight line to peer communities, because it's way out of whack. And you know, it's not as though, I'm always troubled by the fact that, you know, public employees' income is always hanging out there. You know, I mean, it just kind of goes with the territory, but, you know, I guess having spent my life in private business, I just never think that way.
Yeah.
But there it is. There's an interesting message that is sent when somebody decides to look at this from outside. It's like, do I really want to go in there? Do I even want to apply for that job in Reading? Do I want to stay in the job in Reading when I can look at everybody up the line? You know, it's a matter of public information.
Are you kidding me? I apply for the job in Linfield in a heartbeat.
And I have to just add
half the budget.
So those are some of my random,
thank you very
less
much.
Organized
and
thoughts.
No, I think they were well said.
Yeah. And one property pays all your taxes.
Yeah, that's right.
And I must say, in all the discussion you have, Bob, he's the most modest guy. You'd want to engage in this topic. It's almost like he wanted to throw us out of his office. Like, don't bring that up. But we are going to bring it up. Any further thoughts on the board?
Yeah, I mean, I think when you look at the numbers here, it's pretty evident of where Reading is paying the town manager position, and you know, relative to other towns that have similar budgets, similar proximities to Boston, similar residential size.
Yeah.
You know, and that's that to me. When you start looking at those, are obviously the core numbers.
I found that salary per I'm sorry, budget per salary figure. Kind of illustrative.
If you just sort the list by operating budget in one column and salary range in the other, it's
managing a lot of money on a shoestring.
You can see the gap pretty quickly.
Yep. Yeah.
There's a per capita one I did too, which is a little less interesting.
And obviously tonight Bob, you raised this topic of fiscal management in a preliminary way as we look towards the next year, and that's kind of where I think we are with this. My opinion is this needs work, and it's up to us to work it.
Right.
And you know, we should do that in concert with the person that we're working with, and you know, whose compensation we're talking about. So,
anybody else want to weigh in? Bob?
Yep. Just a couple of thoughts. One, I'd like you to, you know, request Sharon to work with HR and make sure the data is good and complete. I want you to make a decision based on good information.
Yes.
Yep.
And we'll get those other peer towns.
Not to say Sharon did a poor job, but I talked to her about this and I asked her how to do it. And she said, I did a listserv email and I got information and here it is. We need HR to vet, to call HR departments and really talk. Because I want you to have the right information.
We wouldn't put you in a position
to
not make a decision based on good information, Bob.
I think
we have to start somewhere.
Yeah, I agree. And secondly, I have thought about the question since you asked me. You know, I may or may not have personal preferences. Well, I guess everyone does. I think above my personal preferences, the most important thing you do is to keep being very transparent and to not hide money places. And you can't really hide it because it's all public sector. But if it's not in the budget, next to the wage line, and it's somewhere else, it's hidden.
Right.
And I don't think that's
the
right way.
Oh, that isn't what I was proposing.
No, I understand.
That's not what I was suggesting.
So is it like deferred comp as an example?
Yeah.
Yeah, deferred comp shows up. I mean, it's there.
Yeah, there is lots of ways, other employees, and I don't just mean town managers, are paid in other communities.
Right.
So that there's not a lot of transparency in the budget. And that's just not
that is, yeah,
business.
That's not
that's
what
not
I was,
us.
Yeah.
That's not what I was suggesting.
No, I know you weren't.
Right.
And just the other thing, if we're going to go back and try to get detailed information, one of the things I think would be helpful is also longevity of the office holder.
Yeah.
Because if the notion
is
you have to pay somebody more new to
you
come
do.
In,
sure. Right.
I'd like to know if that person's been there 10 years or 1 year so that we can.
Yeah,
and also not to tax our HR further than they already are. We should probably give them a list of towns rather than
have
a huge list. Have a
well,
list that is very
we'll do the,
similar
just
to
peer communities be the best thing.
Yeah.
Similar
to
I think that drops it down to about six
so,
or seven.
No, we have the, there's about
20
of them. It was on the first tab. Hold on.
Oh, that you don't
I've
have?
I've got it. I didn't send it around everybody.
There's about 25 communities in our peer.
Yeah, there is about 25.
Hey, believe me, HR
Harry,
knows
I'll
that,
send that to you.
Inside and out, because
yeah.
they're always serving.
But is that the one that
okay.
has like the FinCom, you know, the
yeah.
sort of
yeah,
like the same?
Okay.
It's the FinCom peer group plus the last consultant added two communities. Whether or not you put them in, I don't really care.
You know, on that topic of longevity, I think part of what, you're, I think
that's
you're right to
a
ask that, Barry.
Okay.
Part of that equation is, you know, Bob tells Dan, well, that guy just got hired in Linfield or wherever.
Burlington was new, right?
And so, therefore, they're being paid more. Well, you know, I think part of what we need to understand is not only the longevity in the current job, but how long have they been doing this?
Yeah,
right.
Because that matters, too. You know, and I don't necessarily mean, I mean in a management position in town government. That matters. I mean, you know, you need, it's part of the discussion. And I think that's what you're saying, Bob. Get all the, get as much data as you can get on the human resources side so that we can make an informed decision, one that we can defend as to its rationale.
So I want to know what the guy in Millis is doing.
Yeah.
$28 million of the town budget.
Wow.
Oh, yeah. I saw that one.
8,000 residents?
Wow.
There you go.
I can't even make a joke because I don't know the person. If I did, I could make a joke.
Yeah, I mean,
so
8,000 people with a $28 million
which
budget.
Which night are we doing general services?
Well, I believe it's January 12th.
Okay, so we're
three times in.
We're going to need to be ready to go by the 12th, so we need to meet with once the hall, maybe once next week and then after the new year.
Okay.
Yeah. So we will, John and I will continue working this with Bob. We'll get you guys more data. I'll be sending some additional things as they come out.
So obviously we can't comment amongst each other. So
not outside these walls, no.
No, but I mean in terms of, you know.
You can give me comments.
Reply to you.
Reply to me only, you're fine.
Not to both, because in that.
Right.
Okay. Every time there's three of us,
you can't do it
because it's a problem.
If you reply at all, you're just going to
sometimes it's
blind copy.
Yeah, often if I'm alone thinking it's a problem.
Yeah, I know. So any further thoughts, questions?
I'll talk to you separately, Dan. I have a couple of thoughts.
That's fine.
Okay. All right. Minutes?
Yeah, minutes.
Move the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of October 28, 2015, as amended.
Is that seconded?
Second.
Okay. Comments? All in favor? Did you have?
Abstain.
Okay.
I'm abstaining as well.
Wait, I'm sorry. All in favor? Opposed, abstaining. We have 3-0-2. The motion carries.
Okay. And on the November 17th, I actually have an amendment. Is that as amended in there for intended for me? Already
it's always for anybody who needs it.
Yep.
Okay. Page 2 of the November 17th, right at the top.
What page is that in our packet?
The page on packet is 24.
Okay.
So this is for a public comment, Tony Torre had a couple questions for me. And I was reading this and I was trying to remember it and it was kind of sticking in my head. Cause on that first page, well, it says the depot parking lot was factual. I'll give the full sentence here. He asked Kevin Sexton the comment that we made at town meeting about no one can shoot off a gun in depot parking lot, air quotes, was factual. And Kevin Sexton indicated it was not. It wasn't, he didn't ask if it was factual, Paula. He had asked if it was the town's position or a personal one, and I had indicated that it was not, in fact, the town's position. It was a factual statement at the time, but it was not a town's position. That's why he was on to say it was a personal remark. And that's the only change I have.
Duly noted. Any other changes to the minutes?
Nope.
Nope.
Okay, all in favor?
I move the Board of Selectmen for the minutes of November 17th, 2015.
Sorry.
Got that right in.
Thank you.
Seconded.
Second.
All right, all in favor? Vote is 5-0, the motion carries. Is there any further business to come before us tonight?
Happy holidays.
Yes.
Board of Selectmen adjourn the meeting at 10:21 PM.
Is that second?
Second.
It's you, John.
Okay, all in favor? We are adjourned 5-0. Merry Christmas, Happy New Year.
Happy
Hanukkah.
I have a